Hello, I'm Spencer Scott Holmes, and welcome to the show. Today, got super special guest on here, John Locke, comic book writer, but I know you do a whole lot more than that, too. How are you doing today?
I'm very well, thank you. It's been a bit of a week. I'm feeling it, but kind of it's good. It's the kind of exhaustion that comes from kind of cool things happening. So, yeah, I'm all right, actually. I'm not feeling too bad.
Hey, well, there we go. You know, I mean, I know we got this fun 8-hour difference. I'm here in California. You're over there in England. What part of England are you in?
I'm in Gloucestershire, which is basically is very much the Shire from The Hobbit. That's always just the best cultural point of reference I can give. A few years ago, my wife and I, we went on our honeymoon to New Zealand, and we actually went to Hobbiton. Mm-hmm. And they had all the sets and everything, and we're walking around and we're going like, well, it's a long way to come to look at a place that's exactly like home, only it's about 10-20 degrees warmer. So that was very surreal. But yeah, basically think rolling green hills, quaint little cottages and stuff, and then just us generally bringing the neighborhood down in the middle of it.
Oh my god, well that's cool right there. If I had to describe where I'm at, you ever seen Back to the Future 3?
The
Western one. Literally, right, yeah. Like that place is shot like 25 minutes below where I live at. So like,
oh, seriously, wow, yeah.
So that's the best way I can kind of describe it. It's like that. It's like old-timey Western towns, you know, just in the modern day.
So you're coming up, and also, as you say, it's about midday for you. So like, how hot are we talking? What's the ambient temperature?
Right now at high noon, I guess what we're at, just to give it that Western feel, it says it's 73 degrees out, but I'm up in the mountains, so it gets a little bit cooler than if you're down lower.
Okay, I'm going to have to bring up a conversion chart here, because that's obviously Fahrenheit, isn't it?
Yeah, that's Fahrenheit.
I'm weird like that. 70. Okay. Yeah, that's probably about the same here, to be honest. And we consider that pretty hot. So yeah, it's I went for a walk. You know, I mm-hmm. put sun cream on today. That's quite rare for me. But
yeah, well, I was out for a nice little morning jog, went for a little 3-mile like run through the woods and so on like that. And it was definitely quite lovely outside. You know, I mean, perfect temperature for exercise.
and I imagine, you know, the absolutely perfect day to retreat indoors and record a podcast.
Exactly. Like, well, that's how it is.
Yeah. And if you like me, I've got the curtains drawn to kind of further block out what little daylight there is left.
Oh, no, I got a little bit of sun kind of peering through on my background here. But yeah, no, that's how it is. You're like, you go outside, you get that bit there of mountain air, and then you're like, okay, let's go back inside to where like computers are and all that good stuff.
No, I made a point today. I was like, I'm going to step outside. I'm going to do something very ordinary. I'm going to mow the lawn and then we're going to go for a walk. And that's actually been lovely, because otherwise I probably would have just spent the entire day at the computer. I need that distraction sometimes.
Well, see, that's my kind of thing too, is like, you know, like I like to try to always get exercise in, because I feel that's the perfect counterbalance to the computer. But a lot of times it's like, okay, I work out for 1 hour, then I'll literally go sit at the computer for the rest of my day. When I'm done at the computer, I'll go sit in front of the TV and either watch a movie or play a video game. So it's like a continual like sitting pattern. You know what I mean? Sometimes I feel you need that actual breakup throughout the day to kind of get that. The stress and kind of pains from my computer. Because I always like to make the joke that I get all my injuries from the computer, but I really don't think that's a joke. That's totally serious.
No kidding. Like I have like, I discovered a whole muscle I didn't even know existed, and I only discovered it when it broke, basically. So my psoas muscle in my right side is it has been sore for years, and that comes from just being at the desk for too long, really. It's lack of mobility. Yeah. So yeah, well,
It's that thing that, like, I always think you could try perfect posture. That's a great idea. That might be how you start out. But next thing you know, you're a half an hour in and you're already hunched over like an animal, like working at the computer, just getting that perfect position to get that drawing going, or you're just in that tight mode and whatnot. And yeah, it goes out the window. So I feel the only other way is to counterbalance it with some form of kind of physical activity.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, no. And I think, you know, certainly from being when I was young, like absolutely despising any form of physical activity. Like it was just the worst thing I could imagine. And particularly like where I grew up and the time I grew up in, it's like if you're the one kid in school who doesn't really get football or team sports, like you better like comics or you're not really going to have much else kind of going on. But now I'm like, oh, yeah, I love I love running. I've even recently taken up climbing.
Mm-hmm.
But I do some martial arts, and I'm like, oh yeah, where was this when I was younger? Like I needed this. Now, yeah, I just want to, any excuse could get outside, really.
Well, you know, and that's literally how I felt. Like when I was in high school, it was like the idea that like, almost I felt like working out was just like, it felt like, oh man, that's like what the jocks do. That's what the football players and all that kind of stuff is. Even though ironically, like I was really into Arnold Schwarzenegger, like since a little kid, that was my favorite actor. I watched all his movies, had everything about it, like just super obsessed. But like the working out part, it didn't start to click to like, I literally kid you not, the second I was out of high school, it was like summertime. It's like, I feel like I should need to start working out and someone like that. And that's when I started getting into it and so on. But it was like, maybe I just needed that separation from like that sort of like the jock mentality that like, it's like, oh, wait a second, you know, working out can be kind of a completely different thing. And it has nothing associated with that kind of that sports feel, you know, not saying anything wrong with the sports, but you know.
No. It's more like, I think it's funny you went to Arnold because it's like, I think having realistic role models is a good thing. And I know like I could have been working out like every moment from like 16 to now. And I would not look like Arnold. I don't have that in me. I'm more of like a runner's physique, I think.
Yeah. I feel that's how my body's always kind of been stuck in. It's in about that runner's kind of style. So, but by that standard, you could always look up to Bruce Lee. That's how I always sort of look at it. Like, because I feel yes. like there's two classic physiques that to look up to. It's Arnold and it's Bruce Lee. And it kind of like, when you look at those, it's like you generally could fit into one or the other if you put enough time and effort into it, depending on what your body type is.
Do you know a band, a British band called Pulp?
Yes.
Yes. It's so weird. Like when I was younger, I was like, man, I'd love to be Jarvis Cocker. Like he looks amazing. Like, and I realized I would never be that cool because I was skinny, but I had a massive head. Like I'm like a lollipop basically. And I was like, oh, I'm never going to look quite as cool as Jarvis Cocker. But for some reason, I think kind of like, I was always like, oh man, I want to look kind of like, just kind of like waif thin. Mm-hmm. And I want to kind of like be wearing a rakish suit and be hanging outside a nightclub with a cigarette. And then I realized that was also a lot of work as well, because I just get tired now at like 8 p.m. I can't go to cool clubs anymore. I need to sleep.
Yeah. The sun just set. I need to get home. You know what I mean? Murder, She Wrote's on.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
No, I know that. Well, that's how I was. Yeah. When I was younger, it's like I had that, like, I wanted that kind of like Def Leppard look in a sense, was what it was. So it's like, look at those guys. And then I remember once I got into working out and someone like that, I'm like, boy, those guys are extremely skinny looking. Like, somebody needs to go up there and feed them. What's going on? I mean, I know I'm watching a 1987 music video, but you're like, at first you thought that looked great. Then you're like, man, that just looks like they just haven't ate anything for like a month.
Yeah. And then in hindsight, you're like, oh, yeah, you know, oh, David Bowie, like, he had a real rock star yeah. charm, didn't he? And then you're like, oh, wait, no, cocaine. Another drug, really, wasn't it? Yeah, maybe if I did nothing but cocaine and ate nothing but green peppers and drank nothing but milk and locked myself in my mansion, yeah, maybe I could be a rock star. But yeah, I also exactly. like, I really like sandwiches, so that's just not going to happen.
All right, I know. The sandwiches, that's always the one that gets me, too. It's like, well, you can't go wrong with a sandwich now.
It's a classic.
It always is. But, you know, I was thinking about before we kind of did this podcast, I was like, I remember because I used to do this podcast called the Indie Comics Club with my buddy Craig Johnson, who makes comic books over there in England as well, too, Project Savior. And I know that that's, we did an episode where we talked about, I want to say it was Afterlife, one of the, well, you got so many pages of it. So it's like, I'm trying to dial in exactly which part it was. I know it was in like the more of the earlier runs, but I cannot remember exactly how we crossed paths at that time. I don't know if you just happened to run into us and you sent us like a review copy, and or were you ever on Comic Central with your book? Because that might have been the other place we would have found it. Because
maybe so. Yeah, this is really now. I for the benefit of the listener, like I feel like a fraud here, because here's me thinking like, oh, this Spencer chap, like he's really nice and helpful, and he's given me this platform, and you know I've been pestering him with stuff over the years, and then genuinely, I did not know that you'd actually like encountered my stuff before. I feel completely dishonest about this. Yeah, I don't know. I'm mystified and kind of amazed at the same time.
Well, you know, it was probably about 4 or 5 years ago. So you know, by this age in life, that's a lifetime.
Yeah,
it's a misty view back there. But that's all I kind of remembered, is I knew that we did one of the books. I had like that, you know, early on, you know, kind of talking about just kind of doing review, because the whole point of our show there was that we did. Well, generally it was like, we had like a casual intro that we went into, and then halfway through we're like, hey, I guess we should review some indie comics. And then we kind of would, you know, pull about two or three books up at a time and kind of go through them and whatnot. But yeah, that's how I remember discovering it. But I could not remember how the book came across, whether if we found it on Comic Central, whether if you shared it or what have you, because sometimes by this point, it's like, that's all in the void. All I know is I had that original digital copy sitting in my my digital copy section of comics on my computer.
Yeah, no, I cannot even think what I sent your way or which one you looked at, because as you say, like, I mean, it makes me sound perhaps more kind of like accomplished than I am. I'm not. I just, through sheer, I think, kind of bloody-mindedness, I have ended up with a lot of content now. So yeah, it could have been any one of the books. I do not know. Well, I hope you liked it, whatever it was.
I totally enjoyed it. I remember just like the big thing was like, it's got like one of the coolest ties ever in comic books. That's like the biggest like selling point.
I remain utterly convinced that I ripped that off from someone. You know, I think it's like, you know, when I had that original idea for Jack's outfit, I was like, oh, it'll be like this, but I can't do that because that clearly exists somewhere. And I've still not found it, but I live in dread. I'm half convinced that someone's going to come along and say, you stole my idea. Cause like, I don't know, it hasn't happened yet, but I swear it's coming.
The only thing I can think, it's not a tie, but like, it kind of reminds me of almost like Spawn's cape, where it pretty much has like a mind of its own in every single panel. It's almost like there's just as much thought put into how Spawn's cape's going to be flowing as that tie is going to be flowing in that panel.
No, that's really wild. Cause I can't draw to save my life. And when I started out, I would make a point of trying to like kind of doodle the characters as best I could, because I had a very clear vision in my head of what they'd look like before, you know, inevitably handing them over to someone much more talented than I. And you should see my very, very, very early attempts at sketching like Jack Fortune and co. Because you can see my like... my early love affair with like 90s comics and where I started reading, because everything is just that little bit extreme. You know, the gauntlets are bigger. The tie is basically like, if not Spawn's cape, it's basically like one of Spider-Man's webs. Like it's just everywhere. It's ridiculous. Thankfully. And then other people were like, okay, let's just tone that down. Maybe just by 10%. let's make it palatable.
These go to 11.
Yes, quite. And maybe that was like an early lesson in moderation, where I was like, every panel can't be 11. Like we need some lows occasionally.
Exactly. It's got to have a little bit of a flow and kind of mountainy kind of like void of how it's going through. But yeah.
The weirdest thing is there have been two occasions in my life where somebody has cosplayed as Jack Fortune. And the first one was three. Uh-huh. And I've only seen one of them in person, because I feel so sorry for the guy. He dressed up as Jack Fortune, even got contact lenses in, turned up to a convention that we weren't at. And I felt really bad about that, because then I got all these rumors going around going, oh, did you hear about the Jack Fortune cosplay? I was like, no, what? This is insane. I need to know. And we did track down the dude and we got a photo of it. But yeah, the eternal question is, what do you do with the tie? You know, I've seen some people have just made like an insanely long piece of neckwear, which is like, that's great and all, but I do feel you're now running around a convention hall with a massive choke hazard around your neck.
Tripping hazard too.
quite. I mean, don't get into a lift, you know, something terrible could happen. So I think I've seen a couple of people have put like a foam thing and then like a wire, so they've almost got it wrapped around their shoulders sort of thing. The safest way.
I could think as if you sort of, this is probably not the right way to kind of go about it, but something kind of like in the style of like, if you sort of paper mache'd it, and so it could kind of be stiff and just stuck and kind of circle around you, would probably be one way. I don't know if that's the greatest idea either, but.
No, I think that has to be it. Yeah. And you know, if anyone is tempted, I'd be like, please maintain neck safety at all times and the safety of those around you. Like, do not injure yourself.
That's the one press you don't want. Like, man accidentally hangs himself with tie.
Yeah, they say that like... No publicity is bad publicity, but I think there's a line somewhere we're going to try not to cross.
Have comics gone too far? Yeah, you don't want that at all, but But yeah, and I know you've been writing comics for quite some time, because I know that this one's coming up on a 10th anniversary. But is this the first book you ever did? Because, I mean, as I said, the Afterlife's the one I know you from. But yeah, I know you have a bunch of other stuff, too.
Well, yeah, Afterlife Inc. began life in 2012, which is pretty much when I really kind of got into it. But it's predated ever so slightly by, I did some work for an American couple, husband and wife team who make comics called Comfort Love and Adam Withers, who have been doing a long running indie superhero comic called The Uniques. And I was that kid where everyone's like, oh, what do you want to do? What do you want to do when you grow up? And all the careers advisors would tell you really, you know, sensible things like, oh, I want to be a sports person. I want to get into science, that sort of thing. And I'm the one who's like, I want to write comics. And there was never any guidance for it. So yeah. I was just kind of like harboring this kind of like bitter little seed inside me where I'm like, that's what I want to do. And I don't know how to do it. And then years ago now, after I finished university, I ran away to Canada for a year. And I went on this kind of like comics exodus where I was like, okay, I'll just spend a year, you know, working in coffee shops, working in bookshops, traveling. Went to Calgary Comic Expo in 2008. And I think I was the only British guy in the entire building. And I remember Mark Wade and Greg Rucker. I asked a question at the back of like this panel they were doing. And I think they picked on me, and they were like, you're a bit lost, aren't you? Like, how do you end up here? But anyway, so the long of that is that I met Comfort and Adam, who were making indie comics. And I was like, hang on a minute. You can just make comics yourself without like a publisher. And they, you know, eventually kind of, you know, they gave me advice. They were very friendly. And I ended up writing like two stories for them in an anthology they were doing. And that kind of, I was like, oh, okay, I feel I'm getting the hang of this now. And then I started kind of assembling my first book. But since then, and, you know, I've been doing Afterlife, I think, for a solid decade now. Mm-hmm. I have done a few other things. I have a company called Big Punch Studios. Mm-hmm. We publish our comics, podcasts. We make card games as well. And we did a quarterly magazine, which ran for 4 years, which was 46 pages every 3 months. And that was like an anthology of comics all in like a shared universe. And I am losing track now. Yeah, I've done a few kind of oddities here and there. And I've got another project in the works called Ace of None, which I've been developing for a few years. But yeah, I think my work on Afterlife, I think, basically like pretty much coincides with my life in comics, basically. I think you can just round it to like a neat decade, basically. Quite a busy 10 years.
Yeah, definitely. Well, you know, and that's the one thing I think I love so much about comics is it's such a pure medium that you really, it doesn't take a whole lot of investment to really get into comics. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you generally just need your, depending on how many, if you're going to even work with other people, you're going to do it all yourself. You know, you just need kind of the, you know, just a regular computer can do it. You just need your, you know, in a sense, you're going to use a Titan program, you're drawing, you just need a drawing program, and you can almost keep that same drawing program for like a long time. It's not like video editing where you got to kind of upgrade every couple of years, no matter what, or else you're going to feel like you're missing out on stuff.
You're right. Yeah, because my wife and I were just talking about this earlier, because we're still running, like I do the vast majority of my work, because while I can't draw, I do a lot, I letter, I do image manipulation, and I assemble books in InDesign, and we're still running all that off like Adobe CS5, which you know, I think I bought about a decade ago. It's the same one, like it's all still working perfectly.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. It's like you just like those programs. It's like, you know, if it's as long as it's good enough, you're fine and ready to go. I mean, that's kind of the cool thing about it is just I feel like the investment part is kind of little, but you can create literally any story you pretty much want. I mean, the other medium I think that's kind of in about that same ballpark is if you're writing novels and so on like that. Like that's the most simplest one. You just need a typing program and you are set to go create whatever you want.
Oh, yeah. No, believe me. Like I think my family's generally come around to the idea that like, oh, he makes comics. But I think there were times where like loved ones said, have you considered making like a real book, you know, rather than these picture books? And I and there is a part of me that's like, I almost wish I could. Like I thinking like comic scripts, and I honestly don't know if I have it in me to do a novel. Mm-hmm. I'd like to think I could, but yeah, I've got to say, like, there's times where I'm like thinking, okay, so I've got an idea for a story. I've got to find, got to get a pencil on board, see if they're available. We've got a letter. Oh, maybe what's the production schedule going to be? And I'm thinking of all this crap. And then I'm going like, oh man, if I was just writing a novel, like it would just be me and the keyboard, and I wouldn't have to worry about this.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean, in my mind too, I've always thought about writing a novel as well too, because I just have that thing that, like, if I get into anything, I just go, man, I should do this. You know what I mean? Like, even if I kid you not, if I sat down and watched sports for long enough, I'd be like, you know what? I should be a pro athlete. I don't know what I'm doing sitting here. Like, there's just this weird thing in me that if I just kind of watch anything for long enough, I do. But yeah, it's just that thing that's what makes comics, I think, so nice, is you can kind of jump into it. And because it's, you know, the nice thing about art is art kind of can work in so many different ways. There's, you know, 10,000 plus different ways you can go about it, and they're all right in their own way. You know what I mean? That's what's kind of the neat thing about it. It's not like such a hardcore one that I feel the simplest thing about it is, as long as it's clear and the fun factor's there, you generally have it all kind of right. Like, everything else is all like into like whatever design you want to go with. But as long as it's clear, it makes sense how the process is going, and it's enjoyable, you're set and ready to go.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And it's funny, because I think on some kind of like fundamental level, I think humans do kind of understand comics. Like, I know some people, I think like Grant Morrison's gone, or somebody in, who's a bit more of a comics magician, has said like comics are maybe like the successor to like cave paintings or something like that, where we're telling stories through like pictograms. So I think like on some instinctual level, like it's a very pure way of telling a story, comics in particular. And then I think we're kind of, for some reason, we grow out of it. We're kind of told like they're not proper. And then, and then you come back to them maybe like in your teen. Well, I'm sorry, I'm recounting a life experience from before the Marvel Cinematic Universe, where, you know, comics were a bit, you know, for us, at least in the UK, comics were a bit kind of like, oh, they're weird. Where am I going to find them? You know, you couldn't get hold of DC comics to save my life. Marvel, you could just about find. But yeah, it was so weird, you know, to have carried a torch for Iron Man circa 2001, which I was doing. And I'm like, oh yeah, I love Iron Man. He's great. I bet we'll never see Iron Man on the screen. Yeah, it's a little different now, I want to say, but maybe they're becoming, I don't know, I hate the word respectable, but maybe they're becoming a bit more respectable. I don't know, a bit more mainstream perhaps, but
yeah. Well, I think the character sort of are. Comics as a whole, I still, as things always falls into it, there's just a niche audience for everything kind of comic books. And I think that's just one of those ones that generally, this is what I've summed it up when I go to Comic Cons. I call it like, there's people that read and people that will never read. And you're never going to sell a book to someone who's never going to read. Like, I kind of hate to sort of say it, but like, if that blockade, once that blockade comes up that I don't like to read, you know what I mean? They might like, and that's the thing, they'll go watch a movie about comic books. You know what I mean? They'll watch an animated thing. But the idea of reading, the reading is kind of the block one. And I don't know if it's like this for you in like Comic-Cons over there, but I know that Comic-Cons kind of recently, at least in like California and someone like that, they do get to the point where they just start jamming too many things into one thing. Like, it's called a Comic-Con, but like, let's be honest, comics is maybe 5% of the entire thing. Oh, you got action figures, you got anime, you got video games, you got wrestling, you got blah, 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 sci-fi, all this stuff. And the thing is, you know, I'm the kind of person that I like everything. I'm the kind of, I'm interested in a lot, in a wide variety of stuff, but I know that most people are only into about one or two things. So it's almost like that thing, you got a lot of people kind of walking by that, as I say, I break it down, go like, they just don't read. I can tell it right off the bat. If they don't read, they might think your stuff looks cool, but that's about as far as it's going to go. They're never going to read. They're just going to accept that. And I kind of thought, I'm like, I wonder what it'd be like to go to like a book convention, or if I went to a book convention, would then I'd be like that one, be like, oh, Mr. Funny Pages over there with the children's sections over there. You know what I mean? Like,
get
like,
laughed out of the building. They wouldn't let you in.
Yeah. Why is these guys writing books so hostile?
Well, it's funny you say that, because it's something we talk about a lot, like when we go to conventions, because you're right. You can so instantly tell when somebody is just not kind of going to bite, you know, when they're not interested. And you know, and we don't even you know, we never do the hard sell. We're just like, yeah. Hey, you know, you're welcome to browse.
Like the
want.
Used car salesman, you put your arm around it, like, you know, Bob, can I call you Bob? Let me take you down here.
Oh, don't even
picture yourself reading the book right now. Picture yourself right now. Everybody's gonna look at you with great envy. They're gonna think you're amazing. They're gonna look at that guy and go, that guy right there, he's an intellectual. Don't you want to be an intellectual, Bob?
I gotta say, like, some of the weirdest, like, because we all talk about, like, you know, there's people who, you know, they come to a convention because they're looking for stuff they know and love. You know, oh, you know, I really like Spider-Man. Mm-hmm. I wonder if I can find a Spider-Man comic. And then, of course, you've got the indie comics there, the kind of creators. And we are the oddities. We're the weirdos. Because it's like, okay, you make comics, but I don't recognize any of these characters. And it's so weird the reactions you get from people, because it can go anything from, you know, utter wonder and admiration of people going like, oh, my life, you made this. I can't believe it. That's the coolest thing in the world. To people. And honestly, I have had this reaction. I've almost had people kind of look at me with disgust. Like, this is the most extreme reaction. But I have had a handful of people who've looked at this and gone, what's this then? And you go, well, it's a comic I made. Oh, yeah, yeah. These are your characters, are they? Yeah, they are actually. Yeah, yeah. All right, yeah. And then they just kind of like sneer, and then they might kind of like just like flick a finger across the comic, and then just kind of walk away. That is perhaps the most extreme reaction I've ever had. As if like I've offended them by not being Spider-Man, I guess.
Yeah, I've seen that before, because I will say the one thing about Comic-Con, you literally get everybody out of the woodwork shows up there. You get the people who have never had a social like interaction in the last 6 months, and they finally show up, and you just get bizarre personalities. And that it's almost kind of hilarious when I see that. But yeah, the other thing I noticed too is I'll set up my booth for like Pizza Boys, and like I try to make it as clear as day. I don't know how much clear is day. I'm already at a place called a Comic-Con, and I got a sign that right above it, you know, in the background there's a banner. It says, what is it? It's here's my comic book, Pizza Boys. It's the sitcom-styled indie comic book series, like in big lettering and all that stuff. There's a comic book sitting there on the table. There's other, like, single issues and so on like that. And I kid you not, it's so weird. Someone will pick the book up, and they'll flip through and go, oh, it's a comic. Like, what do you think it was? Like, literally, come on.
The the flip side, I want to say, is I've had somebody come by the table, And maybe this is the dream, and maybe this will resonate with you, but I've had someone come by the table and go like, what's this about then? And like, you know, kind of point at the comic, and you go, oh, well, you know, okay, well, it's a comic I made about, and the guy literally just kind of stopped me there and was like, oh, a comic. Yeah. I love comics. Yeah. Yeah. I'll buy it. Yeah. I'm like, do you want to hear anything about it? And the guy's already getting the money out of his wallet. I'm like, okay, I guess this is the easiest sale I've ever made, but I kind of feel cheap in a way. I feel like he'd buy anything.
Well, you know, I will say this. I remember when I would first go to Comic-Cons, that was the main thing I was looking for. Is like, I want books that I can't just go to the store and find. I want something that's special and unique. So a lot of times, like, you know, people would come up, they'd have their big, you know, pitches ready. And I'm like, you know what I mean? Like, let's be honest. There's five of you indie guy booths here. I'm just going to buy one of each of your books anyway. So you don't worry too much, because I'm going to check. I just want to check it out. I'll do a quick flip through and I'm good to go, because that's what I just came here. So I want to support. Yeah, I like to see what's different.
Makes you a saint, is what I'm going to say. The it's people like you who are like, these are the good people here.
Yeah, well, I realize that there's not as many of us as one would might think, because you know, you'd think a Comic-Con would be filled to the brim of those kind of people. Not as much, you know.
Well, here's a genuine question then: as an indie creator in the US, like how, like what? I mean, obviously, like pre-COVID, obviously, but what's that like? Because I mean, for us, like, you know, we don't have that many shows over here, and the ones we do are generally dominated by one company. But also, if we do have to go to a show, it's maybe like, oh, at worst 100 miles away or something, I'll just hop in the car. Like,
yeah,
this is my ignorance talking here. Like, are you flying across the country? Are you going to, like, you know, New York? Are you going to San Diego, that sort of thing?
You know, I've never went out of state yet for a Comic-Con. So if that's one of those ones that's kind of been, that was one of my big goals right before kind of like, you know, all the COVID happened. I remember I was like, you know what, this is it. I'm just going to start touring all the time. And then that kind of happened. And then I was like, no, I'm going to wait for a moment, because one, like whenever there was those random Comic-Cons, you're like, is it even going to happen? And then they're like, well, we're going to have less people show up, but we're still going to charge you the same price for a booth. And like, whoa. No. Less people showing up, you charge me. If you're going to have half as many people showing up, you charge the booth price half the price too. You know what I mean? So it's like, I kind of weighed on that. And then now, like the last 6 months or so, they've kind of come back. But here in California, you could almost go to between California, maybe Nevada. And if you really want to, like Nevada and Arizona, not going too far, that's still probably like a 500-mile radius. But you could probably hit a Comic-Con every single weekend and there would be
This is what I mean. This is a completely different world to me. Like, this is mad. Like, we were way back, I want to say, like between 2012 to 2016. Kind of like when I was really getting into it, and in the UK at least, and I think kind of maybe post, you know, the Marvel boom really taking off, there were more Comic-Cons. It was kind of growing and growing and growing, and those conventions were getting bigger. And we were honestly getting to a point where we were like, oh wow, we could have like a convention a month, you know, and we felt like, oh wow, this is amazing. Like this is the golden land now. And then honestly, I think from about 2016 onwards, we've seen a bit of a decline in the UK, where a lot of being like closing up. There's really not as many players as there used to be. And you know, we used to get these kind of like really kind of small indie shows, like you know, which might just be like one day in a kind of village hall kind of thing. But they were kind of magical in their own little way. But you know, we'd be talking like, oh, maybe like a few hundred people turn up. And then we go to the pub around the corner, that sort of thing, like really kind of chill and small. And I think now at the moment, like, again, we're really only just opening up again, but it basically comes down to two major players in the UK. We've got the MCM events, which is a big franchise, which is now owned by Reed Pop, who I believe own New York Comic Con, I want to say.
Okay.
Maybe C2E2 as well. And then we have Thought Bubble up in Leeds, which is like the famous one. That's the kind of independent, very, for lack of a better word, arty. They get all the big image names over. It's quite like, oh, big celebrities coming over, that sort of thing.
Oh, okay.
But that's it, really. Like, and then you've just got these small indie ones. There isn't much of a scene over here.
Well, at least that's kind of cool. You got sort of the artsy ones, because the artsy ones seem to be so few and far between in a weird way. Like a lot of the ones here kind of like, I mean, as I said, you got choices from being like the big ones. Like, if you know, you have stuff from Los Angeles to San Diego to Sacramento and San Francisco. But then there's also like, there's all kind of like just the, you know, the regular town. Just, hey, here's a town. It's got a Comic-Con. You know what I mean? And, you know, they're kind of like a, you know, once again, mixed match. You know, you'll go there and there'll be all of like maybe 3 to 5 indie comic book creators, if that, sometimes even. And then you've got the toys and the figures, the fan art, and all the other stuff like that that kind of fills a void. And I know that some comic book creators get so angry about that nowadays. Like, there's a couple guys I know that they get so angry when they see that stuff. It's like one of those ones, like fan art stuff coming in. Like, if you know, they can't make original drawings and all this stuff. You know what I mean? They just get so angry about it. And it's like, I kind of get it, because it throws people off. You know what I mean? Like, I wish, one thing I would love to see is a, it doesn't even have to be that big, but it's just one, it was just purely indie comics. And, you know, maybe you only had 10 to 20 artists and writers and so on like that. But, you know, if you sold it that way, everybody who was coming there knew what they were getting into. I mean, you could literally do this in just like a good sized comic book store would be the perfect ideal place for it. And just know that that's what it is. And you minus out the Funko Pops, you minus out the fan art, you minus out all this kind of excess stuff that I think sometimes confuses the average person, because they almost get this like information overload and they've never really seen a Comic-Con. Cause that's a lot of times too. You get those ones where they do like a Comic-Con, like on a holiday. And that's always the most bizarre one, because all that means is that everybody's up with their relatives for like the weekend. And so they're like, well, boy, I don't want to be here any longer. What's there to do in your town? Oh, you got a Comic-Con? Well, I got $5 in my pocket. I can walk in. And the downfall is they're kind of lollygagging. I get it. Yeah. They have something to do, but they're not going to buy anything. They just wanted to kind of kill some time because they were just hanging out at the in-laws house.
One of the weirdest experiences I ever had. We have, there's a UK one called, the Lakes Internet. Oh, I'm going to get this completely wrong. It's called like the Comics Art Festival or something like that. Uh-huh. And it's up in the Lake District. Yeah. I'm getting this now, in the UK. So, area of outstanding natural beauty, very mountainous, lots of lakes and stuff. And the idea is that, and this is an incredibly arty show, they come in and they take over the town. They take over this quaint little town And every little building, every little shop has got something comic related going on. And we went to the first ever one. And fine show, don't get me wrong. Our stuff did not resonate. It was not. It was not.
Was it artsy enough?
Yes. No. I mean, 100%. Like, I'm just making.
So does this guy hang himself with the tie at any point? No. Yeah. He doesn't.
No. You're joking. But it's like I strive to make entertaining trash, and everything around me is a work of like literary genius. And then it started raining, and we just had kind of like you say, the holiday crowd, where we just had people coming in off the streets because it was dry. I had a guy, I had a print on my table at the time, which is one of my characters, who's a giant blue lion who's on fire, who was standing by a mountain range. And I had a guy come in and go, look at that print and go, is your comic about mountains? I was like, I don't know what to say. I was like, no, but there's a mountain in this picture. And then he started to talk to me about how much he loved mountains and he loved mountain climbing. And in the end, he bought the print because it had a mountain. Oh, well,
you know, at the end of the day, that he can love mountains all he wants. If that's what he bought it for, that is cool. But yeah, I just love how like they literally look past like what is there and they see like that thing in the background. You know what I mean? And that's what they're fixated on.
It's funny you mentioned like, you know, you're saying like, oh, wouldn't it be cool if we had like, just like an indie scene. I mean, or like a convention. I was just indie creators. I mean, that is basically Thought Bubble. Mm-hmm. The only difference is it's a bigger show. And then everyone goes and gets drunk on the Saturday night. Like historically, they were always in the center of Leeds. Mm-hmm. And we'd always have this big kind of after party on the Saturday night. And that was always a really surreal experience because you'd get like all the indie creators, you get some punters. I think you'd have like the Image crowd. So you'd have like all these big names from Image, everyone getting wasted. Yeah. And then one year, Run DMC were there.
Oh, well, there you go.
I know. And it was like, this is surreal. And like Kieran Gillen is being the DJ. And now Run DMC are doing an impromptu gig. And I'm just going, what is happening? Like, this is Leeds. This is Leeds in 2014. This shouldn't be happening. We're not that cool.
Yeah. Well, and then the only thing too is sometimes like they start adding things like that. It's like, this is what happened. I know like at a lot of the big conventions here is once the video games kind of came in, and don't get me wrong, I love video games.
Oh, but yeah.
The video games, the second they come, it's just like, we need a place to put this giant Tekken tournament where you can play against the guy who created Tekken and so on like that. Knock some of the indie comics out of here. That's almost like pretty much what happens. You know what I mean? Like, and then I just watched it. Went from like, okay, there's a booth over there in the corner where a bunch of kids could go play some Smash Brothers Melee. Okay, that's kind of cool. To being like, okay, now the center of the Comic-Con is all video games. And as I said, don't get me wrong, I like video games, but
oh,
I'm like,
sure, yeah.
That almost needs to be its own convention. I think that's the thing, is like, we need to start splitting these things back up again, where if you're going to call it a Comic-Con, like, comics should be first and foremost. Everything else should be sort of secondary. If you're going to have video games or anything else, just call it a video game con.
Well, now it's just pop culture. They're just pop culture conventions, aren't they? Or quote-unquote nerd conventions. Everything they think we'll like. I mean... It's fun and all. Like we when we do MCM London, which is the biggest one in the UK, you know, we as a team, like Big Punch, we really enjoy that show because it's very big, it's very colourful, it's everything you're describing, and our stuff is kind of colourful and a little stupid, and it goes over quite well. So we're grateful to that. Yep. But the comics are, I mean, as you were saying, like we're maybe 5% of the floor plan. You know, the indie creators are getting a discounted table rate because we're comic creators. But you know, the organizers would be like, these comic guys, I mean, they're taking up a lot of real estate, but we could be getting a more profitable company in. It does feel like we're an oddity now.
Yeah, at least you get that discounted comic book rate too. That like they just kind of like shoehorn you into one of two categories here in like California. It's either, oh, you're a comic book creator, so you either go in the artist alley, which generally a lot of the odd times the artist alley, it's like, well, I don't want to be stuck with, I hate to sort of say it, I don't want to be stuck next to all the fan art people, and not saying anything wrong there, but people get confused because if they see fan art, fan art, fan art, then they see your book, they just go, oh, that must be fan art I don't recognize. And that's the downfall. That, like, it's like, you know, no, you got to stick us all together so that people, like, when they get to a quadrant, and, like, you literally need, like, a neon sign that says, like, now entering the indie comics section. Like, so people know what they're getting into, because the average person, they're going through, they're doing that, what I call, like, look left, look right, look left, look right, look left, look right, and keep going, 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 going. And you know what I mean? It starts to blend together. It starts to mold, and they don't see the difference between the person selling, like, Pokemon, like, you know, little pixel art things, to the person actually selling an original comic book.
No, 100%. I mean, we the recent thing is that the MCM franchise over here has been bought by ReadPop, and we've recently seen a kind of change in management and maybe a slight kind of change in approach, because historically, we've had this thing called the Comic Village. So, it's about 20 years ago. Emma Vicelli and a bunch of other creators, they negotiated with MCM to get this discounted rate for indie creators. And I think the trade-off was like, the indie creators, if you're making a comic, you get a cheaper table. And MCM, the convention, they get maybe like a degree of credibility, because then they can say, like, oh, we you know, we're selling Funko Pops, but then we've also got, like, comic creators here,
and local artists and all that kind of stuff.
Exactly. And the Comic Village was very much like everybody is making a comic. You weren't allowed to do fan art. It was, they're all just indie creators. But of course now, the thing we've seen in the last year at least is it's been rebranded. We're now the Artist Alley, and for the first time, we went to our, you know, since post-COVID, we went to our first big show there back in October, and we had a lovely time. We, you know, had a fantastic show. But the, we noticed there were now dudes selling, you know, well, again, not even their own fan art. They were just selling art prints, you know, stuff, kind of like, do a quick Google search, print out, you know, how many photos of Pikachu can I quickly get off Google? And it just felt like, oh, wow, this is weird. And he, that guy did great business.
Well, that's what I mean. Is you see those guys, and it's kind of like, I always call it, let's be honest, you're kind of cheating. You're also doing something that's borderline illegal. You know, even if you draw it yourself, like, some people don't get that. It's like, it has to be in, like, the parody section. You got to be doing, like, a Weird Al song. You can't just technically draw a picture of Pikachu. It's got to be Pikachu combined with something else. You know what I mean?
Yeah. At least do that. That's all I ask. Put a funny hat on him or something.
Yeah. Make him kind of like an original, something kind of different there, and so on. And that's why, like, I remember when I first started out doing Comic Cons, I'm like, well, maybe I'll just do a couple of little fan arts just to sort of have there, just for, like, eye catchers and so on. But then I realized, like, no, it started throwing off, like, because people would see the fan art, then they would see my book, and then they would just assume it's something it must be something that I just don't know. And so I just minus that out, and I felt it was a lot easier when I was just no, I'm a solo property. That's, I'm not in no fan art, all original, like, just stick to that kind of game.
Well, no, quite. And I know it's a very thorny subject. And I think one I kind of mercifully avoid by being a writer and not being talented in that department. But Nick, who I work with at Big Punch, who is an artist, and we talk about it at length. And I think similarly to yourself, I think when he started out, he used to have some fan art on the table, because I think everybody does.
Yeah, well, because you think it's going to be like, hey, they see this and that's going to be the lead in. You know what I mean? And it's not saying that it can't work that way, too. But I think it also confuses people.
I think so. And then also, we ultimately, because we were both kind of creating our own franchises and worlds and everything, and we ultimately landed on, you know, I think his dilemma was, he said, if someone buys fan art of mine, I will never really know whether they bought it because they liked my artwork or because they liked the character. And he said, I'd rather, if I can sell, it's a harder sell, but if I can sell a copy of my book with my original characters to somebody, I at least know that they bought it because they liked my characters. They like what I have to offer. And I think that's ultimately where what we ended up kind of pursuing.
Yeah, well, because I think it resonates deeper, because now they've picked it up. Now they're truly and kind of invested and so on like that. It's not just that they thought, because you think about, like, all the fan art, like, if you've ever bought fan art, do you really remember the artist that drew it?
No,
you know, no, it's almost like next to impossible that you're going to remember, unless it was somebody you specifically went searching for. Like, if you went searching for, like, I want, like, one of those Babstars where she does, like, the weird offshoots, like Batgirl drawings or something like that, you would remember that. But you're not going to remember, just a random, like, hey, here's somebody doing a Speed Racer drawing. You know what I mean? It's like, it's just not going to cross your mind. Just be like, hey, it's a Speed Racer drawing that I thought was kind of cool. That's all you're going to think about it. So I think there is something to be, they sort of separate from that. And then it's like, it's one of those ones, sometimes you get that more focus. Like, okay, what are you really trying to do? Are you trying to do fan art? Or are you trying to create your own thing? Because the other one's going to end up eating up the time of some of your other stuff. So.
Oh, exactly.
I think you want to simplify it a lot of times and just kind of get that down. But I want to say this because we're talking about the con. There's this one con this is one of the ones I thought was hilarious. There's this one in Modesto they do, which is where like George Lucas's hometown is, and they call it Graffiti Town or Graffiti Con because it's based. It gives like they want to give it American graffiti because that's where that movie takes place at, but mixed with a Comic Con, which really just sounds like you had a father son team where dad's like, okay, you know, me and the men are gonna have a car show outside, you know, and you. You know, girls or whatever you want to call your nerdy selves can inside where it's safe and the weather won't bother you. You can have your Comic-Con. And so they have this kind of going on. I mean, on paper, it doesn't sound bad, but the hilarious thing is you get the car guys, they come in and they're looking at all like, I mean, even just between the fan art and the cosplay and all this stuff. And they just got their look on their face like, what is this? Huh? That? Oh. Oh, just they couldn't like comprehend what they were seeing on this Comic-Con when they went to walk through, because you got a ticket to one, you could go to both sections of it. You know what I mean? But like, it was just sort of the reactions were just hilarious, because there was just some of these guys that they didn't see certain anime things like this. And this was a first time experience. You know what I mean?
Well, you just reminded me, like the very first convention I exhibited at back in February 2012. The London Super Comic Con. It was in the Excel Center, so it's like a massive aircraft hangar, but it's organized along like a central corridor, so there's lots of different halls kind of going off it. And at the same time as we were on, and it was like the first UK appearance of Stan Lee in like a decade or something like that, there was a childcare convention, there was a classic car convention. I swear there was like a smoking convention. There was like a kind of nicotine industry convention. And there was also
cigar booths.
Yeah. They had some very fancy booths, I have to say. And there was a Zumba convention. And I remember like we'd gone to the pub after the show, and we were wandering back to our hotel, and there was a late night Zumba rave going on in the convention center. And if you can imagine, it's like, all these incredibly toned, incredibly fit people. Utterly sober. Like, utterly sober.
Yep.
Wearing a lot of neon spandex. Just, like, skanking so hard. Like, just really going at it. Like, neon lights flashing. And I was like, you know, it's kind of encouraging that, like, I finally dipped my toe into the world of conventions, and I'm not the weirdest person here.
I just want to say this one really too. This reminded me of another one. There was one where it was an anime convention that they did in the capital of Sacramento, and right next door was a Greek festival convention going on. So they thought that, hey, if you buy a ticket to one, you could go to both of them. But, you know, the anime convention's got everybody in their bizarre cosplays, you know, and so on like that. And then next door, there's the Greek convention where everybody's like dressed up, you know, going out for a nice dinner. The family's there, grandma and grandpa, you know, from the old world and so on like that. And now it's just intermingled together. And so not only is there, you know, everybody in their nice suits and ties and everything like that, and then there's just the person in like their most goofiest like cosplay known to mankind, or like, you know, very skimpy outfits just intermixed into here, just so confusing, grandma and grandpa. That one was amazing.
It's always like, it's like the circus has come to town, you know, and then you don't know whether to like, are we bringing joy to people's lives, or should I just be apologizing to everyone? It's like, I'm so sorry for what we're doing to your beautiful hometown.
Yeah, that's literally what it felt like. It's like one of those ones, like these two things, I know they're happening right next to each other. And I know that it just seems like an easy sell to say, hey, if you bought a ticket to one, you can go to the other one. But it's one of those ones where it's just like, you know, some things just don't combine together at all.
Did you used to find that like it was hard because, you know, being at a show, running a school, it's, you know, it's kind of like, yeah, every... it's noise. It's like it's sensory overload. You're doing that for a weekend. And then I know, you know, when I was going back to like my day job as well, it was just like, I don't know how to like explain this to people. Like, I can't relate to them. They go like, what do you do at the weekend? It's like, You know, not much. You know, I there's no frame of reference. I don't know how to bring those experiences back to, you know, the quote unquote normal people.
Yeah, well, yeah, I know what you mean, because that's that thing that, like, you know, when you find that other buddy and you start going off on, like, the most longest, like, rant of, like, you know, you're going deep diving into, like, an anime, a video game, a comic, something like that. And then there's somebody just standing next to you, because, like, dude, what are you guys talking about? You're just going, like, insane. It's like, you just don't get it, man. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
you weren't there.
You're at that point where it's like, you get to, you know, you've been talking outside the movie theater for, like, 3 hours, and they finally say, hey, you guys just got to get out of here now. You know what I mean? Like, you're attracting the riffraff.
It's funny because, like, if I do try to tell people, like, they say, oh, you know what? I'm still kind of cautious about telling people what I actually kind of do. And they're like, you know, we kind of make comics and stuff, and, you know, we go to conventions. And they're like, and the first thing is always like, oh, do you dress up? That's like the first question. Yeah. I'm like, well, no, actually, we're like the boring ones who are kind of just like running a table, and we just kind of look exhausted the whole time. But again, it's like that's not really an experience that you can kind of share with people, really.
Yeah, no, it is kind of that. Well, especially when you tell people, like, they go, hey, what do you do? And you're like, oh, I make comic books. And it's like, there's like a pause where it's like, it has to like register what you just told them. You know what I mean?
And 100%.
Sometimes
yeah.
Sometimes it's even like, depending on like what the audience is, sometimes I'll just say, like, you know what, because it can open up too much of a can of worms. I'll just go, oh, I'm a writer. Sometimes I'll just say, oh, that yeah. part. I'll just pick one aspect of it. You know what I mean? And just kind of go. Then they mostly don't question, like, a writer, like, well, he could write for the newspaper. He could write for an internet thing. He could write for, you know, I mean, there's a lot there. You say the comic book ones and it can kind of stop dead in the tracks and just kind of go, huh. You know, like, I like to tell it during, like, if you ever go to like a jury duty or any of those kind of things, you tell them you write comic books. That really will make the lawyer start to question it real quick.
Yeah, I guess if you want to get out of doing jury duty, saying you write comics might be great.
Yeah, I'm a creative storyteller.
Yeah, I feel that gentleman in the back row has maybe made questionable life choices, and I don't want him ruling over my client.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's like, you know, I mean, you throw that kind of wild card out there, but it's always kind of fun anyways, because it's just like,
it's do this to ourselves. Like, there have to be easier ways to make a living, surely.
Oh, there definitely is. I actually literally calculated, like, I'm like, out of all the work I do in an entire year, because, you know, comic books always take up so much more time than you make money at it, but it you know, the wage level is pretty darn low. And I was like, in an entire year, I make the equivalent of maybe like $1 or $2 an hour US. So in all the hours I work, that's about like what I get. Like, so like, if anybody's complaining about their wages, if you make your comic book yourself and so on like that, yes, it can be a livable like income, but it literally gets to that point where, like, I put a lot of work into here, and I feel like I'm working in like a sweatshop in like China.
Yeah, it's, you know, I think about just the amount of time like I pour into this, and I'm like, God, like, what am I doing to myself? Like, I love it. I mean, obviously I wouldn't be doing it if I didn't love it, but like, it is knackering. Like, it's absolutely exhausting. Like, can somebody do it for me? Like, if anyone's listening and wants to volunteer, that would be lovely.
See, the nice thing though is you got to the point where, like, you got at least the team going, because that's the one thing I've kind of fallen into is, like, because I've done everything myself. I write it, I draw it, I ink it, letter it, edit it, market it. And sometimes there's that kind of thing, like, there is that kind of nice thing that, like, hey, I do it all myself. So if I don't have to worry about somebody else failing on me, because that was always sort of the thing in all the other projects I always kind of had, is that at some point, somebody's either not interested, or I used to make movies was the thing I like to do. But then it got to the point where it's like, it was just so hard to get other people that want to come crew with you /act/whatever. And, you know, you, for movies, you need at least a handful of people to at least be able to do it. You can't just do it with like one or two people. You need a good amount. And it was just like so hard to get that scheduling of people and have people be committed, because it's that thing that people like movies, but once they see how much time it takes, then they don't like it anymore. You know what I mean?
Well, exactly. I mean, same for comics. I mean, as you rightly said, like, it's incredibly, like, you know, time consuming. And I have immense admiration for people who are multi-talented and can kind of do all these things. Because, yeah, even if maybe you have like one specialization, you're like, oh yeah, I'm just the writer. As you rightly said, like, particularly in indie comics, you have to be the social media manager. You've got to be the logistics person, you know, you've got to, the promoter, like, yeah, you have to wear like so many hats. I mean, I'm very lucky in that. Like I'm very lucky in that I work with a lot of freelancers, you know, freelance artists, mm-hmm. you know, whatever, who can kind of, well, A, they make my stuff look good, but also they kind of, I could try to learn to draw. And maybe if we check back in 50 years, maybe I'll have come some way. But
yeah,
but you but know, yeah, like Nick, you know, because you know, I've been working with Nick for years now at Big Punch, and it's like we always used to say that like he's an artist, I'm a writer. Mm-hmm. His biggest asset is, you know, time. You know, where can you get the time? Where can you get the time to work on a thing, to, you know, to not have to worry about like the day job or kind of like paying the bills and everything. And you know, for me as a writer, and I guess, you know, producer as well, it was it was money. It was like, you know, well, where can I find the money to pay the people to come on board, you know, to try and give, you know, try and give people a fair pay for their time, knowing that we'd never be able to reach Marvel rates because you know, we're just a bunch of idiots out here trying to trying to survive.
Yeah, well, it's that thing. It's like, you know, you raise the money so that, you know, you can pretty much pay them so they can have the time. And that's how it kind of rolls in. I remember like at first when I would see like the mix of like when there was like a writer and an artist, I used to almost make the joke. I'm like, so what? One guy works 3 days and the other guy works 3 months, you know? But like, then I started thinking about, I'm like, no, the nice thing about it is that the writer, you know, you write a single issue, it doesn't take too long. But then in that 3 months that the artist gets to focus on just the drawing part and not think about anything else, you could do the marketing, you can do the promotions, you can do all the advertising, you can do all like the little in-betweens and all that stuff that kind of gets in the, it gets in the way when you're an artist and you're trying to do it, you're always like, okay, I got to draw some panels. Hey, I got to get some marketing done too. So then it kind of gets in your way there, and then it might kick you out of that creative mode and all that stuff. So there is definitely something to be said about having that team aspect. Mm. And even in like my comics, I've gotten to that point where it's like, it would be nice to have like one other person. Like, and I've almost kind of thought like, what's the most proper way that you keep like the art looking sort of your same way, but you can have somebody that kind of, that can still fill in to kind of keep the time going. I'm almost like, if I had somebody who did the inking part, I think, cause I could still have the drawings. They could still look like mine. It wouldn't be that thing. Cause I know everybody always kind of goes like, well, you don't want to get an artist that's just way better than you. And then it just makes you the rest of your look like, I'm like, I don't know, especially with my artwork. Cause you know what I mean? Like I always made the joke early on that I like watch a writer draw, because that was just sort of how I got. I'm like, I learned just enough that I could, I think I can pull off drawing a comic book. And then as it went on, I just kind of kept at it and so on. But if I had it, I could still, if I had the inker, I could still draw, still have the same look, but it would speed up the process so that I could just focus on the writing, the drawing, someone else would do the inking while I'm doing that, and then I just finish off the lettering and the editing.
That's almost like I'm not a massive manga reader, but like that is that not almost a bit like, you know, if a manga artist, who, you know, often a writer as well, like if they reach a certain level, they'll get assistant artists in maybe to do the backgrounds, you know, or to do you know, finish off some details and stuff. That sounds like what you need. You need like, you could do you could do like a layout, like a rougher panel, and then kind of hand it over to someone just to add the finishing details, maybe.
Yeah, well, you know, there's an interesting one in the special features of like the Dragon Ball comics. Kiri Toriyama has some really neat things. They're kind of like nice insights that also make you feel like clearly you're not doing enough work in life, you know. But like, because he says that he does 15 pages. This is in the 80s of Dragon Ball a week, and you're like, what the? So he's writing it, he's drawing it, and he has an assistant, but he says that assistant only comes in 3 days a week. So he's only, you know, doing so much probably. But I think that guy comes in, fills in some extra backgrounds. Like he did mention once, because I mean, you're pulling these tidbits out of there. You're like, okay, he says he draws, you know, this one background once, and then the next time it shows up, the assistant does it, and so on like that. And, you know, so that's lots of times, I think, in those mangas, they have that kind of style there. Or you will see the ones where at the background, because you could totally tell some of the backgrounds, like, well, that background does not look like the rest of the artwork. It's definitely somebody else doing it who's not credited. I don't know why it is. In Japan, like, the assistants never get credited. I was kind of wondering in the U.S. too, though. You think of all, like, the Image and Marvel and DC. You know there's got to be a handful of other artists that are just there, like the lackeys, that don't credited. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, yeah, you know, Jim Lee did the pencils and so on like that, but did somebody else kind of come in and do a little bit of in-between work and just kind of, you know, help the process flow faster, but they're not going to get that credit on the book?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, I know, obviously, I think we're starting to get a little better at crediting everyone. But yeah, I mean, You think of so many of Jim Lee's an excellent example. Like, his artwork's kind of everywhere. It seems pretty iconic. But you go, oh, yeah, look at this amazing Jim Lee picture. I'm like, yeah, well, there's also an inker whose name.
Yeah.
Clearly, I don't know. And there's a colorist.
Scott Williams, I think, is that's one of the only few ones I can remember just right off the top of my head. But yeah, the worst part too is the inker always gets this like lower thing. That's like, let's be honest, like if there's anything I've learned from drawing, the inking takes way more time than the penciling does. I mean, that depends, I guess, who you are. But
well, and you know, it's also trying to get across to people like how much work, you know, particularly, you know, if you have a team, you know, or how much work you're going to creating like just one panel, which is why. It always kind of like, it's always rubbed me the wrong way when people are like dismissive of comics, because even if you're one person, if you're a one man team or you're an eight person team, it's a phenomenal amount of work to bring one picture to life. And then you're having to do five works of art per page, maybe eight, depending on how many panels you're trying to squeeze in. And it's going to be a coherent story. Like,
yep.
There's so much that goes into it. I'm sorry. I don't need to tell you this, you know, but
yeah, no, that. For the viewers out there, that's like the thing, though. It's like it is. It's like you're doing a lot of drawings, a lot of like choreographing of all like storytelling, flowing, writing, word bubbles, all that stuff.
Yeah, and I'm like, just, you know, please don't. Like, I'm not saying you have to welcome them into your heart, but please don't call them trash, because it's like so much work has gone into them. It's like it's insane, and you know, we've got like a university in our town, and we've got you know, a little art faculty which, you know, we connect with, talk to a few of the lecturers, you know, and you know, we've got all these young kind of kids coming through who are like, oh, you know, I want to be an artist, I want to make comics, you know, and you know, you want to kind of tell them it's like that it is possible to do it yourself, you know, whether you're a, you know, a one person team or you're part of a bigger one. And you know, it's kind of just kind of trying to break the idea that like there's only one particular way to make comics. Because I think for the longest time, I honestly believed that, oh yeah, how do you make comics? Like, you write a script. Oh, I don't know. Marvel gives you a call and like plucks. Next thing you know, you're writing Spider-Man. Yeah. Like, that's how it's done. Like, I had no idea there was like an indie comics community until, God, like I guess like 2011 or something like that, when I started aggressively going to conventions and chatting to people like yourself, other creators, just who were just doing it, you know. And that was like a real revelation for me. It's not easy, like, you know, the bags under our eyes attest to like the amount of work you're gonna have to put in, but it can be done. It is possible.
Yeah, well, and that's the nice thing is, we kind of comes around to it, is that it doesn't really take necessarily a whole lot of money to do it. It just takes time. Like, the time is your biggest factor. And that's why I feel like that's why I try to get as much free time as I possibly can, so I can get that work kind of going, because that's more important than anything else. There is gathering the time, and you can accomplish anything you want as long as you have that time, you know what I mean, and getting those projects going. And, you know, it's like the ones kind of going back to like comics, it's like the one that I found, like it was the comic book company that when I first saw that kind of said like, hey, I think this is possible, it was the Oni Press books. And I kind of ran across those with Scott Pilgrim, and then the rest of the stuff that's all in there, like Black Metal and all those things. Those were the books I remember opening up. And to me, it's like, you know, because if the thing is, it's like, I love Jim Lee, but when you read all the Jim Lee and you look at all that artwork and stuff, that's like the thing, like, why bother? If I didn't start when I was 2 years old, I'm never going to achieve this. This is too much detail, too much all this. You see all that stuff, and it's like, it's amazing, and I love it, but it's one of those ones that's almost creative-wise, it makes you not want to sort of make comics. But then you see the ones where they're kind of like the casual, cool, fun drawings, and, you know, they're not perfect, and the lines might not be right there, and the perspective's not all there, but, like, it still works and flows, and you literally like it just as much as all those highly, like, put-together DC and Marvel ones. And I see those books. It was like literally Scott Pilgrim was the one where like I kept saying like, hey, this is possible. And I like it. It's a story, sort of slice of life. It's got all the references I kind of like, you know what I mean? It's fun. It's good times. And just the artwork's like that kind. You look at it and you're like, I think I could do this. I think I could. The Jim Lee stuff, I don't know. I definitely didn't put enough time into that yet. So, you know, maybe in that 50 years from now, maybe. But till then, like, this here, these books are awesome, and I love that kind of stuff.
It's funny, isn't it? I think you do need a, I maybe I don't know maybe it's arrogance is the wrong word, but I think you need a little bit of like, I could do this, you know, whatever it is you're going to do. And like, I think, you know, for me, it was looking at like all these comics I grew up reading and loving, you know, work mm-hmm. by Grant Morrison, you know, all these weird stuff from the 80s that like Vertigo was putting out. And I was like, I reckon that if I had a chance, I could maybe do something. It's maybe not as good, but it's maybe mm-hmm. passable. And I guess yeah. like that was the thing. And like, you know, nobody told me no in a way. So I just kind of stumbled into it. Like, I think you do need like, again, arrogance or confidence to just go like, yeah, maybe I could do this. Like, what's the worst yeah. that could happen sort of thing. I think that's the only barrier to entry.
Well, and I think that's a good one, is you just kind of go, you know, who cares? Just do it. Don't think too hard on that part. Like, that's the thing, because that breaks down a lot of people as they think about like, oh, no one's going to like it. Oh, I'm not too sure. It's not going to work out. Like, you throw that out the window. You throw that out the window and you kind of go into like an ignorant bliss and just kind of say, hey, you do you. You know, at the end of the day, if you do what you like, your thing, that's going to be what makes you unique. You stick to your style. Like, even if you think it's like, oh man, I can't draw nearly as good as Jim Lee, who cares? That doesn't matter. That doesn't matter. Cause you know what? If you draw you, you will be doing your own thing. And that's what's so important, I think, is just doing that kind of stuff. It's better to be more unique than to be perfect, I guess, is what I'm kind of getting at.
Yeah, no, quite. And I know, and that's a really good one, because I think you could go mad trying to achieve perfection. Like, mm-hmm. I would rather make 10 mediocre books, and frankly maybe I have, than waste like the time that's gone into that trying to make the perfect one. Like, mm-hmm. I hate looking back at my earlier stuff, because I just go like, oh, I wouldn't do that now. But while I'm here like soul searching and agonizing over my earlier work, at least I have some earlier work, because I just kind of went for it. Like,
yep.
If I screw up, I'm like, okay, the next one will be better. You know, I'll improve somehow. And
yeah.
And then suddenly people start to think you know what you're doing, and they're like, oh yes, you know, clearly, you know, that they, you know, that John's got his head screwed on right, because look at all the books he's made. And I'm like, they could be awful for all I know. They could be garbage. But people, I don't know, like quantity starts, people start to think, oh yes, no, clearly they're good. I don't know.
Cool. I'm sure they are. There's a charming thing of it. It's like, this is a kind of example that I like to use too, is like, you look at like the very first South Park episode, where it's like literally Trey Parker, Matt Stone, like hand make that entire episode. And it's like, you know, if you compare it to like what South Park looks like nowadays, it's like, you know, it's a humongous, ginormous change. But seeing that process of everything like that, like, cause that was another one too. It's like, just seeing those episodes, we're like, man, that, like, that's all you got to do to make a great animated series. This is awesome. You know what I mean? And as time goes on, it stacks and stacks and stacks, and you can build up. But that, the only way you're ever going to build up is by just doing the first one, and then you work your way through.
Yeah. And it's a classic example, because not only, as you say, was it janky as hell, but then mm-hmm. it kind of took off. Like, it looked like nothing else, and it still does. I mean,
yeah.
Like, they just had an idea for a thing, and they've ended up creating something so completely unique that it hasn't been replicated. I mean, at least. Yeah.
But it's its own style. Like, if you see those cutout kind of characters, like in those squatty kind of designs, like, oh, you're doing a South Park character type thing. And so it becomes its own unique look. So it always kind of goes to show that you, once again, you don't like, that's the cool thing I think I like about art. It's that thing that like, you could have the most well-defined Greg Capullo looking like Batman artwork, or you could literally have stick figures, and as long as, once again, the story flows and it's entertaining, it all works. You know what I mean? It's not as important as much as like the flow, the fun factor, and all that good stuff.
Oh, exactly. No, and it's why, I mean, I'm so continuously in awe of artists, anybody who can bring something to life on the page, because I don't know, like maybe I've got a really good story, maybe I've got a really bad one, but because comics are a visual medium, it's the mm-hmm. art that's going to draw people in. And like you're saying, it doesn't have to be, I don't know, it doesn't have to be Frank Quitely, but like, is it visually appealing, whatever the style? Does it make you want to find out more? Like, yeah, like, I'm so grateful to the art, to every artist I've worked with, because they've always made me look good, and I've worked with a lot of artists, and they've all had very different styles. And no one is better than the other. They all just bring something a little different to the table.
Yeah, they're all unique in their own ways. And it's sort of like, it's like a balance thing too. Like, you know, one aspect can kind of be off. And like, I think as the creator, you see that and you're like, oh, that's going to throw everything off. But it's like, I'll use this like a movie example. It's like, okay, in a movie, you know, you got the acting, you have the concept of the story, you have the look of it, you have the action and all that stuff. Like literally one of those things can actually be totally off. But if the other ones are all hidden, you don't even think about it. You know what I mean? It's that thing like why you can have a movie that doesn't have the greatest acting, but like the action in it's so good, you totally could care less now. You know what I mean? Because the action outweighed the other one. And that's a lot of times it. You don't always have to have every aspect like hit perfectly each time because one of the other aspects will sort of carry it, you know? And then maybe there'll be another point where, like, you know, it's like in certain comic books, you'll see them where, like, eh, maybe the art's a little bit off, but the story was amazing. You know what I mean?
Oh, sure, yeah.
You know what I mean? And you don't think, you think of the overall large picture of the whole scheme.
Oh, no, 100%, yeah. And, yeah, and God, I feel like there's a quote here which someone has said, and I'm probably going to completely ruin it, but isn't it something like, you know, bad art never killed a good story or something like that? I feel I'm misquoting somebody here, but you're right.
It's like a paraphrase of some kind, but
yeah, it sounds smart. So I'll claim it's a quote. I could have just dreamt it up. I don't know.
Well, there's like a rule that I use with working on stuff is I call it the 90% rule. And what I do is when I make anything, it only has to be 90% good. I don't worry about that last 10% to try to hit what is perfection. Because one, is there such thing as perfection? No. But you watch a lot of people when they create stuff and they're like, oh, I just got to get it perfect. I just got to get it right. And so on like that. And they'll spend years even trying to get their script going, just trying to get their art the right way and so on. And it's just like, you almost kind of want to be like, dude, you could have just had like 6 issues by now if you would just went with it. Like, as I said, like I look at my art and I go, Is it perfect? Maybe not, but is it 90% good? Okay, 90% good. Next panel. Keep going. Yeah. Keep going. And the same thing with my scripts too, is I just feel like that 90% is just got to be good. Cause if you sit around, you'll spend way more time on that last 10% than it took you to get 90%, which let's be honest, the average person going through, they're going to see the 90% stuff and that's just going to filter in. They're not going to be like, oh, well, there's something off right here. No. That's you looking at, cause you looked at this drawing for the last 5 hours. Of course, you know, you're going to notice that kind of stuff. They're gonna flow through it at like 3 seconds a panel, you know what I mean? And the little things aren't gonna matter as much as the big picture.
No, 100%, you're right. And no, absolutely. And yeah, you've perfectly described something which I've never really been able to articulate. But yeah, it is so much better to get a completed work out the door than to get a perfect piece of work. And also, as you said, like, you know, the horrible, the bitter irony of comics is that like as much as you are having to produce even on a simple page, like 5 individual pieces of artwork, probably when you're reading it, it's maybe, as you say, every panel is maybe like a few seconds. Like,
yeah,
I personally love comics, but I'm a very fast reader. And even like the best comic in the world, I kind of race through. I'm sorry. I'm sorry to the creative teams. I should maybe like slow down a bit.
Well, I remember I used to have that thing too. And I kind of thought about it. I was like, man, I'm reading these comics like so fast that like you literally almost like look at them for like a, you know, just seconds, just enough to read it. So I started to think like, no, slow down a bit and then like read the panel, take in the artwork, next panel, read the panel, take in the artwork, next one. Like you just add like an extra 2 seconds to every panel you do. It's not asking much. And then I felt like I kind of like absorbed a little bit more as I did it instead of like reading it like it was a novel.
As I alluded to earlier, I'm a massive fan of Grant Morrison's run on JLA from 1997. Yep. It was a very influential book for me. And my friend and I, PJ, we do a podcast called the JLA Cast where, sorry, this isn't a plug. I swear this is a point.
That's okay. There's nothing wrong with plugs now.
But we do a podcast where we've been going back through Morrison's run on JLA an issue at a time. And that's been a revelation because I've been reading those books for years, back and forth. But when you're like, okay, for one episode, we're going to do one issue. We're going to do 22 pages over the course of like an hour and 45 minutes. You go slow. Like that's probably the slowest way you can enjoy a comic. And it's been like, I don't know. It's been like learning to appreciate fine wine. Like I'm suddenly like developing like, oh yeah, the nose, the bouquet of this comic. I'm getting like nuts and old leather, that sort of thing. And like I've gained a whole new appreciation for it.
I love doing those podcasts where you sort of really deep dive and you really dissect and you can kind of go into it. And like, sometimes it's that thing is like, you keep the issue sort of shorter and you can talk more about it instead of trying to cram in like, oh, let's do the entire graphic novel. I mean, not saying you can't do that in one podcast, but like when you really take one at a time and really kind of get into it and talk about the nitty gritty and so on like that, that's always really fun. I love doing that.
I don't know if it says more about us as presenters than it does about the actual kind of episode, but we've done 57 of them now, and we're basically like, okay, so basically it takes us one issue. We can talk about one issue in on average an hour and 40 minutes. Like whatever we try to do, it always kind of ends up being exactly an hour and 40 minutes. So I don't know if that's like the optimum time needed to digest 22 pages, but I don't know, maybe a smarter person than I can do some research on that.
Well, it's just that thing where I feel like it's just whatever it takes for you to kind of get into it. Because sometimes there's certain things where it's like, you know, I'll go into a podcast and I go like, man, like, you know, is there really going to be that much to talk about? And like, you know, whatever movie, comic, or whatever the heck we chose. And the next thing you know, it's like you're talking about it for like hours. And you're like, oh, of course, there almost was way more than I actually would have thought. Because, you know, and sometimes that's the misleading thing. There's like the time frame thing is, you know, you'll think that like, oh, well, you know, I need like a 2 hour long movie. So to do like an hour and a half podcast, but that's sometimes you'll get like that 45 minute movie and you could talk almost more about that than you could a 2 hour long movie. You
know? 100%. Yeah, no. And then also like when you get into the swing of it, you just end up talking about anything and everything. I mean, yeah, I mean, heck, I'm just realizing like I opened this podcast on a weird little diatribe about the Shire. And yeah. I regret that now in hindsight. I apologize to you and your listeners and to podcasters in general.
Well, you know, it doesn't matter because I just think it's kind of fun to have all that. It's all the little things like that that kind of add up to the big picture and so on like that. You know what I mean? And yeah, you know, it's like one of those ones, like even just deep diving into the fun stuff. Like one thing on my other podcast, Old Man Orange, I like to do is me and my buddy will read like scripts of movies, like versions that weren't produced. So you get like an earlier draft of it and so on. And we'll go through like literally like the entire thing, you know. Read it all right beforehand, and then so it's right fresh in your mind. You jump into the podcast, and you talk through it and so on like that. And that one's just it amazes me that I'm able to retain the, like, you know, in a sense, a 2 hour long movie of, you know, in a script form, like the whole way through, and actually kind of remember and go through the parts and have fun with it and kind of see the cool ideas. Cause, you know, like anything, you write a script, in a sense, you can write with an unlimited budget. You know, when a movie comes, there's that thing where it's like, whoa, take this scene out. This is going to cost way too much. And this one here too, get more scenes where it's just the two guys talking together. That's cheap and easy to shoot. We can do it in an apartment, you know? So, I mean, you get that as like the producer aspect, but some of the ideas you find in it, like one script that's amazing is the original Super Mario Brothers movie script that's there. Like, and the ideas too is like, it's really dialed in. Like, I mean, cause you got to think about like the people writing it. I just picture like, they gotta be like in like their 40s. So Mario, they're not playing video games. They're not like that. They just kind of came in this project, but they get the material really well. And they made a really amazing script. And don't get me wrong. Like, I actually like the Super Mario Brothers 1993 movie a lot. I've probably done more podcasts on it than anybody else known to mankind. I want to hold that Guinness Book of World Record.
I haven't seen that movie in so long. I really want to revisit it.
See, that's the one, like, I used to watch it all the time as a kid, you know, had it on VHS, DVD. There was a 25th anniversary, and they did a screening in Oakland, California, and we went out there to go watch it on, like, the sort of big screen. It was this big screen, but in a tiny kind of theater thing, and it was just, like, 25 guys or something like that, and we just had a great time, you know, enjoying it and just things like that, just finding it all there. But yeah, my kind of goal was always like, I want to do more podcasts than anybody's ever done on that movie. And I think we're at like 9 of them or something like that.
do you need to get Guinness on the phone?
I think I do. I want that to be in there. Like the most podcast done on the 1993 Super Mario Brothers movie.
I mean, I don't know. I was about to say like, there can't be many contenders, but
no, I don't think there really is because there's people that do it. But like, the thing is like, There's a lot of people that do it because, you know, they're like, oh, here's a stupid movie, boo, 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 boo. And my kind of whole thing in life is I like to be the kind of guy that I like to be positive on everything. I don't care what it is. Like, it's easy to talk to negative. That's really easy to do in life. You know what I mean? That's the easiest thing is, like, you see a movie you disliked, you and your buddy could talk about it for 3 hours why you disliked it. You see a movie you absolutely loved, sometimes you can be stumbled by about 30 minutes in the conversation. And you get a point like, yeah, it was good. cool action. You almost kind of start to go kind of like a little bit like a moron for a second there. Cause it's weird how that is, because you can't like nitpick it as much. So I try to do it like, that's the hard part. It's the challenging part is like, what did you love about it? Especially on things like, now Mario Bros. I just purely love, like not in an ironic way or anything like that. Might just be childhood nostalgic, but it's always been there. And it's just like, that to me was one of my favorite things. But when it comes to like other stuff that like maybe there's like other people don't like, I try to go like, well, what was the cool parts about? That's what I ask instead.
Oh, yeah.
Because everything, the worst movie in the world might still have great cinematography in it. It might have great, you know, like there might be a cool action scene that's maybe it's only, a few seconds long and like, the rest of the movie's not that great. But there always is something to take away.
Oh, exactly. And I think I feel like. You can I think I'm quite a cynical person deep down, but like. I don't delight in if I see something and I dislike it, I don't think, I'm not just gonna rag on this thing. I'd rather just if I've got nothing nice to say, maybe I'll just be quiet about it, you know.
Yeah. That's how I feel. I mean, I'm not saying they can't be like critical on stuff, but I just feel like when people like base their whole like, oh, let me just throw this thing in the gutter and kick it while it's down, it's just like I think you're missing the point, because I think there's always something to be taken away and everything, and you could always find some kind of sparkle of truth, even in the worst of all things.
Oh, for sure, yeah. And even if the only thing you take away from it is going, like literally, even if you're like, oh, I cannot find anything positive in this, then maybe the takeaway is, oh, I've learned maybe how to do it better. Like maybe it's taught me a lesson here, and I'm gonna apply that somehow.
Well, it's like when I was into movie making a lot too, like the more the movies that actually make you want to make movies more are when you watch bad movies, because bad movies kind of like, you know, you watch Steven Spielberg and that gives you, once again, it's that's literally like the Greg Capullo of like, you know, as far as like making movies where it's like everything's dialed in, it's all there. Like, how are you going to top this? But you watch a bad movie and you go, man, if they did this, I could do this I think I could do it better. Like you get that kind of feeling going in there, and you almost kind of learn sort of all these kind of cool tips and tricks from like the movies that are sort of off that I think are more inspirational than the movies that are like dialed in too much.
Have you heard about, I can't remember their name, but there's a Japanese creator, Japanese artist who had a theory about, he called it his bad, good artist theory, where he basically said that like, there are four types of artists in the world. And he said, there are good, good, bad, good, good, bad, and bad, bad artists. And he basically said, bad, bad artists, he said, are, you know, bereft of, you know, really just hopeless, you know, don't even waste your time. He said, good, good artists, he said, similarly, he said, do not waste your time. He said, some people are just operating on a different level. You will never be able to reach them. Then it's the two in the middle. And he says, you can be a good, bad artist where you're not quite there yet. Maybe there's like some flaws in your technique, but you can see the potential and you're growing. And but basically said what everybody should be aspiring to be is a bad, good artist, where it's like you are a good artist, but you've got some flaws.
Yep.
But you know, you're working on them and they don't distract from what you do. And I think that's kind of, I think if like you talk about Greg Capullo, it just kind of reminds me, it's like, I could pick up a pencil tomorrow and I could start trying to draw and it might take me decades. I will never be Frank Quitely. You know, I could start training tomorrow. This is thematic. And I will never be Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah, exactly.
But maybe I can be, I don't know, a slightly better version of me, but with like a few flaws. Like maybe that's a bit more aspirational.
Yeah, well, it's like the many of things. It's like being yourself is almost more important than anything else you could possibly do. You know what I mean? And that's the thing that I think a lot of people like. You, it's almost that thing like, don't worry about what everybody else is doing. I think that sometimes that could be like the worst thing is if you. It's almost that thing where you do too much research and then you're like, oh, I don't know if I should do it anymore. No. It's almost better like to not know a bunch and just say like, hey, you got the gumption, you're ready to go. Just do it. What's the worst gonna happen? Like, you know what I mean? Like, find out.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. I mean, you know, I think you were saying earlier, it's like, you know, you could tie yourself in knots just going like, oh, are people going to like this? Are people going to like my stuff? Are they going to like the story? It's like, do it and find out, you know, and if they don't like it, do a different story, do another one. Let's see what comes next, you know, or maybe in 10 years time, they'll look back at it and go, Oh yeah, we were wrong about that. That'll be exactly. The kind of the misunderstood early work from a genius creator.
Yeah, it's just that kind of thing that I think that as long as you're just sort of learning throughout your whole process, and really the best way you're going to learn anyways is by doing it yourself. Like your own trial and error, I think, is much more educational than any form of education, any amount of reading you can kind of do and so on. Not saying that you can't have that stuff there, but literally the trial and error. It's like, that's why I think the best thing you can do if you want to learn how to do anything is just have projects in mind and continuously make them. And you're just going to only get better and better and better. Like, you know what I mean? Like that's the simple thing of it, is just the more you can kind of make and the more you can kind of work and the more time you can put in, that's more important than anything else. You know?
Oh no, 100%. I mean, like, you know, particularly, you know, with comics as well, which is, as you're saying, like, you know, the barrier to entry that, you know, nobody tells you you can't. So you're probably just as qualified or more so than the people already doing it. Like, you know, give it a shot. Like if you're reading comics, you've seen them in action. Like you've probably on some level picked up on the language of comics, like the structure of comics. Like, you know, you probably know more than you give yourself credit for. You probably know what works. You know what you enjoy. The trick is just kind of, I don't know, easier said than done, but trying to do that yourself, really.
Yeah, exactly. It's just that kind of thing. I mean, I remember even like because I was originally drawing, like I knew the one thing. Okay, I'm not as good of an artist as pretty much anybody else out there, but I do have all these kind of years that I put into making movies and things like that. So at least the one thing is, if I can't draw nearly as well, at least I know what camera angles and all that kind of stuff are and where to place characters.
That is another impressive skill, because again, I'm like, wow. Yeah, I mean, I think making comics is challenging. It's like you made films. I mean, that's remarkable in itself.
Yeah, it's just one of those ones like that. That was kind of my goal when I was in high school. I'm like, man, that's what I want. I'm like, movie making all the way. I did that, and I also wanted to do music, and I thought that would be a cool combo together, you know. And as it kind of went on, then as I said, just got to that point where you find out like, what can I do sort of by myself? And at least I know that the only person who can fail me is myself, and I know that I won't fail myself. So there we go. It's all gonna work out.
You've got it, Spencer. You got it all. You got the movies. You got the music. You got the comics. I mean, you're basically the Renaissance. It's incredible.
But that's what I kind of just fell down what I call there was multimedia, and we had this class literally in high school that was like the most experimental thing. Like literally none of the teachers knew what was going on. They're like, here's a multimedia class. What you're going to learn in it is photography, like creating a website, audio recording. They literally had podcasting in there. And I remember at that time in like the 2000s, it's like, especially as a kid, you're like, who's going to listen to a podcast? You know what I mean? Like nobody wants to listen to that. You know, this is so proto that time period, you know. But all that stuff was sort of in there, like diet, like kind of put in there that like it kind of became like, I just learned this kind of full spectrum. Now, granted, as the class went on, the kids kind of, the second that videos were introduced, nobody wanted to do anything else. It just became movies, 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 like primal, like nature kicked in.
So I did hear that correctly. There was something on the curriculum about like podcasting.
Yes. In the podcasting in like 2005, like imagine that.
There must have only been like two podcasts at the time. Like, that's insane.
Yeah, as I said, we just went over our heads. And no, granted, I remember kids in general, like I think like nowadays it's a little bit different. But I even remember like when I started doing the podcast and I was also doing animations at the same time. And the 10-year-old kids that liked it would come up and be like, what do you do that podcast for? Just make more animations. It's just like, well, the podcast is there to fill in the time between the 3 months it takes to make a 5-minute animation for you.
Jeez Louise.
Kids get attitudes. Like they like your stuff, but they also want to yell at you and tell you what you did wrong.
Yeah. It's
that 10-year-old mindset of like almost like bullying older people.
I guess you have to learn pretty quickly to have a slightly kind of thick skin, I suppose. although I'm still working on that. I'm still a remarkably delicate flower when it comes to people criticizing my work. The typical like tortured artist. I'm like, oh yes, look, please review my work, but only if you love me, because you know, heaven forbid you say anything mildly negative, because I'm very real prima donna.
Yeah, there's always that kind of stuff too. It's like one of the ones I'm like, yeah, they're I guess they're gonna say something, as long as you take the positives out of it and whatnot, and you know, I guess some people like to just kind of have that kind of way. That's why a lot of times, like when it came for me, when I was doing reviews and so on like that, I'm like, I don't want to, because I create a comic, I don't want to be the person like, who am I to really almost even say, I don't want to point out, I'm like, I'm only, if I like a book, I'll talk about it. But if I, you know, if I don't like it, I would rather just pull it off the shelf and just go, okay, not going to do it. You know what I mean? Cause I feel like that's sort of the difference, is like one of those ones. It's like, I mean, like I could point out the things that I, you know, that kind of like sort of bother me, like in sometimes comics, it goes with both indie comics and that. It's like a lot of times for me, it's the background thing. Cause there's a lot of books where it's like, dude, where's the backgrounds at? And this even happens in Marvel and DC comics. I'll find it and be like, are you kidding me? Like this entire, like two pages went by and there's no background. Like what the hell is going on here? Like that's like always my kind of thing. I love backgrounds. They don't got to be perfect or anything like that. I just like those kind of cool detailed backgrounds. Like they can be sketchy, they can be out of perspective. I don't care about that stuff. Just give me like let me know where I'm at. Like if it looks like I'm floating in the abyss the entire time with these characters that, and I always feel those are the ones where you can tell that the artists, they're good at drawing people but nothing else.
Yeah, it's funny. Like you're clearly not. I was. This is my ignorance talking. Like I didn't even know that like backgrounds were quote unquote such a sticking point. But like, I remember, again, Nick talking to me and telling me, like, from an artist's perspective, he was like, oh, you know, when he was younger and he'd like upload his artwork to DeviantArt or something. And he said, and I think he's thinking like, oh, this is quite a good picture, actually. Like, I hope people enjoy it. I hope I get some good feedback. And like the only comments would be people going like, oh, wow, you draw backgrounds. like that was it. Like the only takeaway is like, OK, well, what did you think of them? I'm like, oh, no, that's commendable in itself because you did them, I guess.
Yeah, because that's the thing is backgrounds aren't, and that's the thing is that after I kind of said it, then I felt like, well, now I got to make sure I always have kind of more detailed backgrounds because I put myself into that kind of hole that I mentioned the backgrounds and now I always kind of do that, you know, it's like that. And then I always say like the only other indie things that like gets me, and it's like, it happens actually in a lot of stuff, is like when things get way too wordy. And this also happens a lot in indie video games. You'll get some thing where it's just like, you pick up like a memo on the ground and it's like 15 pages long in the video game. I'm like, whoa. Resident Evil would have got this dialed into 3 pages. What are you doing putting this like 15th? Like, let me stop my game and read this here for the next half an hour. Like,
oh God. Like, yeah. And if I have learned anything over 10 years, it has been to talk, and I appreciate the irony of this, talk slightly less.
Yeah.
He said, having just spoken for like an hour and a half, but like,
yeah, I know.
In my scripts, like, Lucy, my wife now, she does basically the vast majority of our lettering, at Big Punch. And she will quite happily kind of just, you know, give me a well-deserved slap around the head if I'm like, she's like, you cannot put this many words in a panel. What is wrong with you? And I'm like, but I'm already much better than I was 10 years ago. Like, well, I think I was born with a thesaurus in my mouth back then.
Well, you know, and for me, what it was is because I grew up watching Quentin Tarantino and Kevin Smith movies. And that's like the thing is you watch that and you go, man, those long dialogue scenes, those cool parts where they're just sitting at the diner talking about nothing. Like, and I think that's the thing is like, those are the ones like where you feel like you want to write those, but you got to be so careful with those ones. Those are like those ones that they can be such a dangerous one, you know, where you don't want to have it where like someone's like, oh, this guy's just full of himself, just going to town on like what he thinks is super cool. You know what I mean? You got to have the perfect balance, because that's the thing, is it can work in some situations like a Kevin Smith movie or like a Tarantino one. But like if you just have that ever so slightly off, next thing you know, you got the world's longest dragging scene.
Oh, my life. Yeah. And, you know, and again, particularly in comics where it's like, you know, oh, I've written a, you know, 1,000-word essay, and it's like, I want to get it, I want to shoehorn it into this page. I'm like, ah, oh, yeah, but you know, I don't want to have to add more pages to this, so we'll just have one really wordy panel. And I'm like, no, because it's got to flow as well. And then the next thing you know, you just have one character talking across like 17 pages, and I'm like, okay, if you pace that out wonderfully, it's going to be a masterpiece. If you don't, you're just being incredibly indulgent right now, and you probably need to cut some stuff.
Yeah, well, that's another thing I learned too, is like when you have those, because every once in a while you have to have the kind of the thick paragraph. There's no way you get around it. But as you get it and you split it up, and the panel's the key thing, because it's almost like there's a weird thing when you're reading a comic that like if there's too much words all at once, it has this weird intimidating factor. And I think it's because you weren't coming here to read a novel. You were coming here to read a comic. And if you see two thick sections, it could be a sticking point, but if you break it up, so it's like, oh, here's, it's literally the, we haven't taken any words out, but now it's spread across five different panels and you get new scenes and new perspectives and new angles and so on like that. Now it works.
Well,
now
it's okay, because, you know, the art and the writing are meant to be working in harmony. It's like, you know, you're not at war with each other. You know, you often hear about, like, you know, oh, who's more important, the writer or the artist? And I'm always like, it's completely like,
yeah,
facile argument, because it's like that. It's the story that's important. They're both working on it. Like, you can't have one without the other.
Yeah, that'd be like asking who's more important, like in a movie, the script or like the director. I mean, you know what I mean.
And then you're like, oh, I don't know, like the camera lens, you know, the film print, like, for crying out loud, like
that guy with the boom mic. I think that guy's the most important.
Yeah, it's mad, isn't it? Like, it's funny. It's like there are no rules in a way for making a comic, but then there's also kind of like there are guidelines where you can kind of, if you've got an eye for it, you can go like, oh, okay, the dialogue is crowding out the artwork here, or the artwork is screaming out for some dialogue. Like, you know, there are no rules for everything where you go like, oh, you know, a comic page has to have five panels and maybe 2 to 3 bubbles per panel. For every rule like that, you get like Alan Moore.
Well, yeah, there's always the guys who that's the thing, is that's why everything can work. That's where I feel, that's why I've summed it up. I call it like, as long as it flows and as long as it's enjoyable. That's the two things. If you hit those two, and that goes for like almost anything in, you know, media. That's a movie right there. Is the pacing good and is it enjoyable? Well, you knocked it out of the park. Don't even worry about the rest of it. Everything else is like, it adds into the experience, but those two things are almost more important than anything else, you know? And I think that's the same thing with a comic. And I'll even say, like, there's even fantastic big writers like that sometimes will hit those weird walls where it's like, I remember there was a book that Scott Snyder had that literally it would be a comic book, and then all of a sudden there would just be like 2 pages of literally a novel. And I feel, once again, you're like, if I was reading the Scott Snyder novel, I wouldn't even question it. You know what I mean? But like, when you read a comic book, it feels like you just literally crashed into like oncoming traffic, you know, and now you're like stuck and you're like, what is going on? Like, we just, like, the pacing just went out the window, and it's so bizarre to kind of have like that, you know. And once again, there's a time and a place that you can fit, anything can work. That's what I always feel. There's no such thing as something that can't work. It's just, there's a time and a place for all that kind of stuff.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. And, you know, it's, I think of, I don't know, someone like Brian Michael Bendis. And it's like, I found his work, for me, has been, I found it quite kind of polarizing over the years. Like, sometimes I think it's absolutely, you know, he's firing on all cylinders, you know, something like Ultimate Spider-Man.
Yep.
And then, you know, I think of like his later Avengers work, where I'm like, I'm not a massive fan of it. And I feel like, oh, it's, the wordiness doesn't seem to be serving the story at this point. And like you said, anything can work, but there's context sometimes. And yeah, what will work in one scenario, what won't necessarily work in another. Oh, like Spider-Man is having like these amazing, funny, insightful kind of internal monologues, and he's cracking wise the whole time. I'm like, okay, this is great, I'm enjoying this. And then it's like, okay, we've got a whole team of Avengers, but they're all talking and thinking like that, and they're all talking at once for pages and pages. And I'm like, maybe in this scenario, that's not quite the best fit.
Yeah, that's the thing, is you got to kind of approach everything sort of like slightly different and kind of know what you're going at. And that's I think that's always the interesting thing too, to always think about, is even the guys at the top tier of like the game could still like fumble left and right, you know. And that doesn't mean anything bad. That just means that, like, you know, you're trying different things and so on like that. And, you know, maybe it works, maybe it doesn't. But the nice thing about comics is there's always another issue. You know what I mean?
Oh, sure.
You know, and I don't think it's, you know, necessarily, especially at the end of the day, once you've done, you know, 50 years of comics and so on like that, and you have a copious amount of material, you know, I mean, there's always gonna be those one guys that are gonna remember that one panel you did, you know, 35 years ago, that just, you know, that stuck with them for their entire life. But let's be honest, the whole big picture of it all, that stuff gets kind of faded away. And I think all the higher end stuff is all what rises to the top.
Oh, sure. Yeah. And yeah, I mean, it's like in any medium. There's like, oh God, it's like Isaac Asimov. No, Isaac Asimov. No, I was going to pull another quote out, and I realize I've been doing a lot of quoting, and I won't. But no, you're right. I'll just say, like, it's a surprisingly experimental medium. And I wonder if, as you said, it's because there's always another issue. You know, yeah. It's like when you're having to constantly do something new, I think it forces you to not be too precious about it, because you're like, there are deadlines, and there are double-edged sword, because on the one hand, like, having something hanging over your head going like, this has got to be done by tomorrow morning, it doesn't matter if it's perfect, you just got to get it out there. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh no, I feel terrible, like I'm so stressed the whole time. But the beauty of it is that it has to be done. You are going to make something one way or another, and maybe it won't quite be perfect, but yeah, as you say, next month you get another try, we'll do it even better, you know, and in that time you've suddenly made two comics or three comics, and you know, it's funny, as an art form, it always seems to be very closely tied to the production model, if that makes sense. Like, I'd love to say we can just go all sit in like a mountain retreat and spend 20 years just making the perfect book, and then we can bring it down and give it over to people. But no, as it happens, like out in the real world, on the kind of cutting edge, you just have to be churning stuff out. Mm-hmm. It doesn't all have to be a winner.
And I'm going to use this example. I know I've said this before on podcasts multiple times, but I think this one always makes sense to me. And you remember when Axl Rose was doing the Chinese Democracy Guns N' Roses album, and it started like literally in 96, and it didn't even come out till I think 2008. And by the time it did, and it's not, when it finally came out, it's not that it's a bad album, but that's the example of, he's trying to make it perfect over and over and over and over and over again. And at the end of the day, it's not a bad album, but it does not feel like an over 10 years in the making album, like how it should be. Instead, it would have been better if he would have just had five other albums in that time period. And then who knows, he probably would have had a lot more hits and more relevance. And, you know, there would have been way more material you would have, and so on like that. Like, I think that right there is something I always think about. And that's where it comes into that, once again, that 90% rule. Don't worry about it being perfect, or else you're going to have a Chinese Democracy issue, and it's never going to be perfect. See, it's going to, at the end of the day, you're going to be like, it's a good album, but it's not. I'll tell you this, the other five Guns N' Roses albums before it are probably better. So even the cover one, just saying. Yeah.
No, it's really smart. Yeah. Cause you could go mad trying to be perfect. And at the end of the day, you don't really know what perfect is, because maybe if he'd gotten just, as you say, like five albums out in that time, maybe some of them would have been stinkers, but like,
who cares?
Probably one of those albums would have been someone's favorite. Somebody would have enjoyed it. Yeah.
There would have been just that much more material you would have. There's also, like, I know we're going like quote tracks here, sort of, but paraphrasing. There's one from Paul Stanley, A Kiss, that I always kind of liked. And when he talks about, like, hey, you know, if you think you have a really good idea, don't just hold on to it thinking that, like, oh man, I'm going to savor this one and have it for like some other time. He's like, no, just, you know, make it now, make it how, you know, it can be. Cause here's the thing is, you're going to keep having more ideas as time goes on. You know what I mean? So you might as well get your ideas out that you have now, cause you're going to have more ideas in the future anyways. And you don't want that to all kind of run into yourself. Like, don't think this idea is so good that it's like, you got to save it, and like, there's going to be a better time for it. No, the best time for it is right now.
Well, you see, that's very profound, isn't it? Yeah. I'd like to one up you in this battle of like decent quotes, but that's so good that I can't think of anything to say.
See, Paul Stanley has all those great, like, he's one of those ones, because there's also that one that, like, it's on like the hell's that heavy metal documentary that's The End of the Western Civilization Part 2. And there's one where like Paul Stanley's literally just like laying in this bed, shirt off. There's a bunch of like women around him and everything like that. And he's talking this quote. He's like, people are out there are going to tell you that you can't do it, and that there's no way, you know, you're never going to be able to achieve this and so on like that. He's like, well, here's what I'm going to tell you. I'm going to tell you it is possible. And the reason why I say it is because I was able to do it. I'm just like you, and you can do it too. It's one of those ones you're like, well, Paul Stanley sitting in his mansion and everything like that in 89 telling you that it's possible because, hey, he worked his way up from the ground level. I guess we all can do that too. Why not? I love that kind of inspiration you kind of get from things like that.
And because we all were desperately chasing the rock and roll lifestyle, we all got into comics, which of course is...
I feel that it's like anything. It's like, I feel that it all kind of can have a presence of sort of like a feel of like, even, you know, music can tie into books, can tie into novels, can tie into movies, can tie into plays and so on and so on. Like, that's why a lot of times I sum it up as that multimedia experience, literally one, because I had that class that kind of gave me that rounded education. But it's like, at the end of the day, all those things, it's all storytelling. And that's what I kind of learned in my whole process, is what I like most in life is the storytelling aspect of it. And it really doesn't matter what I tell that story in. If I wasn't telling it in comics, I could tell it in movies. I could tell it in songs. I could tell it in, you know, television. You could tell it in novels even, you know what I mean? Like podcasts, you know, it doesn't matter. It's like the storytelling part is what I like out of everything in it. And I think that's my favorite thing, you know, to talk about, is just stories in general.
No, 100%. It's funny because, you know, I'm sure this is something you felt as well. It's like the longer you've been doing a thing, and there's a lot of admin, if you will, or the boring production-y kind of jobs which are associated with anything creative. You know, they're going on behind mm-hmm. the scenes. And I get a degree of satisfaction out of doing those things. I like ticking off a box and saying something's done, but I think ultimately I am happiest when I'm telling a story, when I'm writing, or be it for comics or whatever. Like, that's probably when I'm happiest. And I think if there's something I think on a personal level need to work to do to address, is I need to reset that balance a bit, because I think I've definitely found, certainly in the last couple of years, I've swung more towards doing, I'm spending more time doing the admin-y kind of stuff. I'm spending more time doing slotting into this kind of like production role, really.
Yep.
Whereas like I'm like, oh no, I know when I'm happiest. I need to get back to that. Like, I was doing I was working on some bonus content for the new book, and like the last few months it's been nothing but like talking to printers, kind of like resizing artwork and all that kind of boring stuff, but which is so, so vital. But then mm-hmm. as part of that, I was like, oh, we're gonna do this bonus story. And so I was working on the script, and without even realizing it, just for like a week or so, I was like, oh man, I'm suddenly back. I'm on another level. I've forgotten how good it was to actually be making stuff. I need to be doing that more often.
No, I feel you there too, because it feels like the last couple of months to myself is like, I'm working on all kinds of things comic book oriented, but at the end of the day, I'm like, God, I'm just not getting very many pages out. I'm just, you know, I'm working on a panel here and there, and whether I'm working on the marketing part, whether I'm working on kind of like the stuff that kind of goes around it. I even feel just, you know, I mean, it's even like recording a podcast and someone like that. I feel like it all ties into the book somehow, some way, but it's extra multimedia stuff that goes there. You know, I've been working on just different variations of prints and designs and stickers and things like that. Just kind of doing some test things at like the house. And so on like that, just, I wanted to like be able to kind of run it myself, and I could make my own decisions and, you know, don't have to worry about minimum orders and all that kind of stuff. I could test things out. But then next thing you know, it's like you do all this stuff and you're like, boy, the whole bread and butter that I'm supposed to be doing is writing and drawing, and I haven't done a whole lot of that in a while.
I know, and it would be wonderful, wouldn't it, if we all need a personal assistant. We all need like somebody who can just kind of take the load off. And I think that in general would make comics like so much easier for everyone, like just having a helper.
Yes.
But yeah, God, I can sympathize massively, because yeah, like I think in indie comics in particular, you are required to be everything, you know. You're wearing so many different hats, you know.
And, yeah,
and so often, like, the time, you know, you're not wearing your primary hat very often, really.
No, yeah, at the end of the day, yes, it's that kind of thing. And I mean, I've talked about that so many times. That used to be like a running thing on like the Indie Comics Club podcast. It's just like, boy, if we just had an assistant, if everybody kind of had their own assistant, like, you know what I mean? Like, that would solve so many of those issues, so that you can kind of keep going, and just somebody can always take care of all those small things of like, yeah, doing the thing where, yeah, you're resizing your comic book, or you're putting it into Kindle so you can make the panels and all those little extra things that you have to do so that it's out there and it's presentable and so on. But they eat away at your time of like what you need to be sort of doing. And, you know, it's just that many things. There's only so much time in the day, and you can only get so many things done. And sometimes you got to, every once in a while, I have to do that thing where I stop myself and I go, okay, what is most important? And then check the things off that, like, are you just doing this because it seems like kind of a fun, neat extra idea, but is it really, is that really going to push, in a sense, the book forward and the stories forward and so on? And then you kind of go, okay, let's back it up a bit. And okay, this is what we're focusing on. This is the most important things. Cut those other things out for the moment.
No, I can. It's funny. I'm very much resonating with what you're saying right now because I've become quite addicted to ticking off a job. Let's be
Yep.
able to say like I've done a job.
Oh
It's
yeah,
like,
you check that off. You have that like the to-do list. Oh, it feels so good. But then so the worst part too is then you overwhelm yourself. And then the downfall is you get to one of those days, be like, man, I only got two of these things out of the six list thing. I thought I was gonna get it all done. And you start almost getting kind of angry at yourself. And then it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. What are you doing? What are you doing? No. Pull it back. And that I've almost kind of got to the point just recently. I'm like, you know what? If I got a full day, I only need to get two things done. You know, if I get any more done, that's bonus. But I only need to get two major things done, and that's it. That's it. I don't want to have anything more than that because next thing you know is like I'm kicking myself for no reason because I just ran out of time. And it's like that's not proactive in a sense.
No, or you get kind of because you're so obsessed with going like I need to complete something. I need to say I've completed something that you start kind of gravitating towards the mindless admin jobs because you're like, okay, I could kind of sit down and try to write something, but that's really hard because I've got to be compelling and interesting and have emotion and stuff. Whereas like I could just manage like this spreadsheet for like an hour. And I'm not going to get any kind of great satisfaction as a person, but I do get to tick a box at the end. And then I feel something. For a moment,
You feel
the
that,
scratch.
and it does. But and the one thing too, I will say is when you do those kind of admin jobs, they do kind of like they could kind of kill the creative spike. So I try to never do those things first because if I do those, then a lot of times I know it's like, well, drawing's going out the window today, writing's going out the window. I feel if I want to make sure I get that going, I try to do those first and foremost. And then once the artistic part burns out, then I can go in and do those ones. It doesn't always work that way, but that's kind of like my goal to try to get.
No, I think that's very wise. I think I just know for a fact that like later in the day, a lot of my creative juices are just kind of burnt out anyway. So yeah, I can it definitely makes sense to be starting early while the body and mind are relatively fresh, you know.
And when a lot of times I feel like because starting early, what I like about that is I always feel that kind of pre-noonish time for me at least. I know that I always call it that's the time that nobody's really going to take away from you. Because once it gets past noon, you never know what's going to come up in the day and what might rob you of the time that you thought you had, but then it goes away by that point. So that's why I like to try to get things done earlier. It's weird because when I was a kid though, I used to like I felt like I did all my like creative work like later in the night. You know what I mean? Like you and your buddies would come over like if you're doing like high school stuff, and then like you would work on the project till like 2 in the morning. You know, writing things and drawing things and editing and all that
Oh,
kind of stuff.
those days are long gone. I mean, like this is a curse. You go like, oh, great. I've been doing anything for like 10 years or so. And you think, oh yeah, what an achievement. And then you realize that like, oh yeah, but now I'm 10 years older and I can't stay awake past 8 p.m. you know, because I am just dead to the world.
And to me, it's like I get to that point. I'm like, no. This is my relaxing time. This is where I'm going to kick back and play a game or watch a movie. And that's just kind of how it is. And I feel that's important because I like to have that balance. I never want to get to that point where like you're working continuously and that's all you do. Like, because that every once in a while you get that point where you're like, oh man, I'm working 16 hours a day. This is awesome. And you're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Pump the brakes here. Pump the brakes. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I feel like you need to have like that Chinese philosophy where you got that halfway balance between work and enjoyment, and you balance that whole thing out. And I think that's in a sense, because why do we write stories anyways? It's because we were so involved in other stories. And I think that's so important to make sure that no, you still are out there and you still are part of it. You still go watch a movie, you still read a book, you still play video games and things like that, because that's what will inspire you in the kind of creative process.
No, 100%. And I think, oh, sorry, I should apologize. Like a fly is just kind of buzzing around the room right now. And I think it's doing little orbits past my head. It might come up on the mic.
I haven't heard it yet, but I know that pain every once in a while. There's like it's like a jungle in here. So of course, like a jungle means that like flies love to come live in it too. There's too
And
many plants here, so
not enough plants in the house for me. But again, summer has kind of arrived. And so the windows are open. And now they're just being a nuisance. But yeah, no, I think kind of like I was alluded to earlier, like I think I definitely need to kind of like redress that balance because I've reached a point where I'm not spending enough time kind of relaxing. We've had too many kind of projects on the go. And I think if I can when we get this new kind of book kind of out into the world, maybe I'm making excuses and kind of bargaining and saying, oh no, it'll be better in the future. But I'm like, if I get this book out into the world, I think that's the point where I pause and go, okay, like I need to kind of like just reassess how we work on this kind of stuff. I feel we got like a couple of projects just in the pipes where I really need to just kind of clear them out. And once they're done, I'll be like, okay, now let's pause, reassess, and then, well, frankly, probably start all over again.
Yeah, that's always happened to me too. I used to always say, I'm like, once I'm done with a project, I'm just going to take like a good 2 weeks off, kind of get really like, kind of like you just take a break, take the mindset off of the continuous work on creating something, and just really kind of refresh myself. That mostly always goes out the window. I kid you not. I'd be like, 2 days later, I'm already like writing my next idea or something like that. It's like, yep, and here it goes. Well, whatever. I guess that was good. That was going to last. So that's why I try to balance it in the day. A lot of times it's like once it's 5 o'clock. You know what? Calling it a day right now. Just going to end it right here. We'll start again tomorrow. That's okay. I got enough done, whatever. It's just that point where it's just like, I want to kick back for a little bit.
No, agreed. And I have to say, I'm well aware that I think it is the sun is, yeah, it is pitch black outside here in the UK. And this might, again, I do not wish to be rude. This has been absolutely lovely. I'm aware there might not be a lot of energy left in my brain.
That's okay. I was looking at the time anyways. I'm like, well, we gone on for quite some time, but that's what happens. That you get those good conversations going, and next thing you know, you just want to talk forever and so on like that. And a lot of times I've always said, like, you know, I try to keep this podcast about like the give or take hour and a half mark or something. So just like, because there was a time, and like, since I've been doing podcasts for so long, I mean, I have done those ones where they're like 3.5 hours plus, and you're like, well, Joe Rogan does it. Why can't I do it? And be like, well, it's probably because you don't got like, you know, somebody really interesting on the other line to be talking for 4 hours. Nobody's going to want to hear you and your friends talk about Batman for 4 hours long.
Oh, no, believe me. Like, this has been lovely. Like, it really has. But like, I think I'm just like, well, on the one hand, it is really nice to talk to somebody outside of kind of my immediate circle, because I've had such tunnel vision lately where like I'm just working on this one thing. I'm not really socializing. I'm not really getting out at the moment. So yeah, this has been lovely. But yeah, you're right. Like I think there's maybe like a natural limit where, regardless of like how interesting the conversation is, and I'm assuming I'm interesting, I might be awful.
No, I think we had a good old fun time. I think so.
Thank you. That's very encouraging. Yeah.
I think we jived well. I think it all worked out. It felt to me, it was like good, inspiring and all this stuff. I mean, one of the main reasons I like kind of doing this podcast and talking with other people is because I just realized that the older I get, I don't see people as often anymore. So if I don't talk to them online on a podcast, it's like this is like my new way of socializing and talking to people, is this kind of variation. Because if not, I'm just in here working on like my comics, and you kind of realize that you just don't see people, especially when you're the only one creating on it. So it's like, I want to go out. I want to talk to people. I want to hear about the projects to inspire me on my projects. And I feel like it kind of circles around, and hopefully even the people listening, is they're getting inspired to want to make their projects. And I think that's the most important part.
Oh, I hope so. Yeah, and while we didn't go in with like an overarching theme or a plan for this episode, I do like to feel the idea that like if us two idiots can do it, anybody can.
You know what I mean?
I think that should motivate anyone, basically, because there is like, believe me, like they let us do it, so yeah. you've probably got a good chance of doing it as well.
Exactly. I mean, half the time I always say, hey, if I can do it, what's stopping you from doing it? You know what I mean?
Ben Grimm was like, we're just too stupid to quit, basically.
Yeah, exactly. But I know you got Afterlife. Is that going on a Kickstarter now, or is that coming up? I can't remember.
No, it's happening. It's happening as we speak. Okay. So yeah, the Afterlife Inc. 10th anniversary collection is on Kickstarter right now. And I am shocked and incredibly happy to say that we are fully funded.
Oh, there we go.
Which is wild to me. We launched on Tuesday. It's a Sunday now. We're fully funded. Starting to discuss stretch goals. Although, if I'm honest, I've just been apologizing to people because I'm like, hey guys, I like to be optimistic. I was not imagining that we'd hit it this soon. So like, I was really just expecting we'd be crawling throughout the month. So now I'm like just kind of like, okay, I guess now we'll start talking about some stretch goals. But it's been a really kind of like just shocking and incredible week. And I'm still kind of, yeah, I think I'm still stunned. I'm still stunned by it, basically. And I'm like, I'm immensely grateful to everybody who's backed the project. It's kind of humbling, really.
Oh, you gotta like that part. Well, I'll make sure to put a link in the description so you can go check out Afterlife Inc. at the Kickstarter. Go help fund that farther. You know what I mean? Because just because it hits the fun goal, that's just the goal part. You know what I mean? That doesn't mean that it can't go far. I think some people see it, they're like, yeah, he's doing good. He doesn't need any more. You know what I mean?
Yeah, this is where we can all just coast now. You know, nobody has to do anything now. We've got 24 days. We can just sit around, take it easy. It does not matter.
No, but if you're really, but like the bare minimum.
Yeah, but I would say if you're at home and you're like, you know what, this book does sound interesting. Maybe I'd like it. You can at least back now, knowing that there's a very good chance it will be a reality. So
yes,
yeah, it's 10 years of comics, over 800 pages as two big hardbacks. So
yeah, two massive ones there. Really fun stuff. I always really enjoyed it. And so on like that, I think you should definitely go check that out. John, where else can people find you? You got a website, you got Twitter handles, any of that fun stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. Probably if you want to check out my work, the best place to go is www.bigpunchstudios, kind of spelled exactly as it sounds. It's a big punch and it's a studio. Basically everything we do there, including After I Think, you can find it there. There's also a link to where you can read After I Think online for free. We've got podcasts, we've got a ton of free comics you can download. And on Twitter, I'm John Locke Comics, so JONLOCK Comics. And there's me just me hanging out, kind of just being a bit boring really, but yeah, I talk about some of my projects there.
Well, see, well, that's all the places to go. Link those in there too. So you got the kind of multimedia experience going too, of, you know, all kinds of stuff, podcasts, comic books, all that fun stuff. But as we're wrapping up the show, you can always go to oldmanorange.com because that's where you'll find my work, as in Pizza Boys Comics and all the hundreds of, well, gosh, almost at like 800 plus podcast episodes now, and all my shows combined, all the podcasts there, all the animations, all that fun stuff. But John, thanks so very much for coming on the show, hanging out. I think we definitely got to do this again sometime. Nothing but good times, I think. You know, we can talk for hours. Maybe, you know what we should do on the next one, too, maybe? Maybe we'll pick a Batman book or any of the Grant Morrison kind of run type stuff or whatever you kind of find tickles your fancy. Because I know I have that Grant Morrison book here, but there's all kinds of other things. Maybe we'll have to deep dive into one of those.
That'd be amazing. And genuinely, thank you for having me. And if anyone's listening is thinking like, oh, maybe that John was an entertaining fellow. Believe me, like 90% of that. The 90% rule came from Spencer because, again, like he made this happen. He brought the thunder. He's got that energy. He's smiling. He's a good host. Good time. I think you know that, people. That's why you're listening. But yeah, he's a lovely guy. Thank you, Spencer. This has been delightful.
But yeah, if anything, come on Old Man Orange podcast, because that's a lot of times where we do all kind of the review stuff and so on like that. And we can have a good old time. I mean,
I'd love you to, like, yeah.
You know, DC stuff, that's always a big thing there. But till then, I'm Spencer Scott Holmes with special guest.
John Locke. He's here as well.
And we will see you some other time.